Great regrets that I'm not with you for the 4th annual Lifestyle Medicine Conference. I'm very excited about the conference. I was just here in Lithuania to be part of the first lifestyle intervention at UPA. And it was just a tremendous experience. We put 10 people through a lifestyle intervention program and watched their transformation from ill health to much better health. For many of them, evidenced by lab results that were quite impressive. I am so excited about Lithuania and the efforts that have been made to make this possible. I truly believe that Lithuania has the potential, the opportunity to become sort of the center, the epicenter of lifestyle medicine, and not just a leader, but really the leader globally. And this is because of the climate within the sort of political world of Lithuania for lifestyle medicine. And why lifestyle medicine? Well, what we're seeing is an epidemic, a tsunami of chronic disease globally that is responsible for about 70% of the deaths on this planet. And the way that medicine has treated these chronic diseases to date really is by putting a Band-Aid on people, by treating the symptoms of the disease rather than to treat the cause of the disease. In lifestyle medicine, we're treating the cause of the disease. We're getting to the basically lifestyle diseases are because of the way we eat, because of the way we move, because of smoking, because of drinking. These are the four main factors. When we address those factors, we see remarkable reversal of disease. I can tell you from patients that I've worked with, from people that have experienced using lifestyle medicine as a treatment, that you can completely, in many cases, reverse disease, especially diabetes, heart disease, and sometimes other chronic diseases as well, including some types of cancer. So this is something we need to take seriously. It's really time that we recognize the immense power of lifestyle medicine for treating chronic disease. And I congratulate you all for being here, for the organizers of this conference. This is really the beginning of many more to come, and I wish you all the best for this day and for the future. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you. Rusiškai nekalbėsit, išsijungti paskaitės.
Klausykit, aš net nežinau, gal net reikėtų geriau įpilti į stiklinę.
Jo, kad ką jie čia nedarys?
Ne, čia tai nereikalas. Čia važiuos viskas.
Va,
paprastai, žinokit, kiek būdavo, nei vienas negeria.
Tai, įpilsit.
Nei vienas, nebent užsieniečiai geria. Čia blogai, blogai su šitų visų dalykų, aš nežinau, o šitų visų uzbonų nestatykit.
Jo, viskas, aš pastatau tris.
Bet tai jie dabar nežinos.
Žinos, jie čia matys. Labas norės,
kas atsipės. Čia dar tą indą mitbils, žiais pasakys. Thank you.
honorable guests, dear colleagues and friends, it's my honor and pleasure to open the fourth annual Lifestyle Medicine Conference. And you see that today's topic is solution for prevention and reversion of chronic diseases. I'm happy to welcome a big group of our friends from abroad, the world famous leaders in lifestyle medicine who came here to share their experience and to contribute to the development of our training and research in lifestyle medicine. I'm really honored to have with us Dr. Vytenis Andriukaitis, European Union Commissioner for Health and Food Safety, the Minister of Health of Lithuania, Professor Aurelius Veryga, officials of university and university hospital, and I am particularly happy to see here so many colleagues from healthcare sector and beyond, and our young students who came here to learn. So I am really looking forward to the most interesting presentations today. And now I would like to invite to welcome conference participants, Vice Rector of University of Health Sciences, Professor Kęstutis Petrikonis.
Good morning. Dear Commissioner of Europe, dear Minister of Health, dear General Director of Hospital Kauno Klinikos, dear friends, specialists, world name specialists in this field of lifestyle medicine, dear colleagues, students, and guests, it's my pleasure to say a few words, welcome words, you to in this conference. And a few days ago, we celebrated International Happiness Day. Day of a happy in the world, and for me it's very important to remember that we are happy when we have a balance of four main chemicals in our brain. At first it's endorphins, it's opioids, endogenic opioids. We are stimulated. We are produced when we are working very hard, when our muscles working. And the endorphins help us to survive and fight pain. Why we have to work very hardly? And we worked in this program to develop a program, lifestyle medicine. At first we worked very hardly. Second chemical is very important to have a happiness feeling. It's serotonin. It produced in our brain, in our body, when we have bright light, when we have comfortable feeling. And we have in this direction of development of lifestyle medicine, we have bright feeling, bright light in the end. Third of chemicals is dopamine. Dopamine is produced when we are achieving something, when we are rewarding for some. And why we have to have short wins. And the short win this year in lifestyle medicine in our university was first seven graduates in this program, and we achieved it. And we were very happy. It's third chemical. Fourth chemical is very important to feel happiness. It's oxytocin. Probably women know, because it's produced when we have touching, when we have feeling each other. Why we need the group, why we need the network of people who are working in this direction. And my wish for this conference and for development in this field is to have all these components and to be happy in the end of this story. Thank you for coming, and I wish you success in this conference.
Thank you, Vice Rector, for your kind words. And now it's my pleasure to invite Dr. Vytenis Andriukaitis, European Union Commissioner for Health and Food Safety, for welcome and presentation. And until Dr. Vytenis Andriukaitis is coming to the stage, I just want to say that he is a great supporter of public health and lifestyle medicine, both in Lithuania and Europe, and he is really doing all his best to make this true. So, welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed for your kind words. But of course, I would like to start with a very excellent message, because we have a really good opportunity to celebrate World Happiness Day. You know? World Happiness Day, it means the same like it was enshrined in WHO Constitution. What does it mean, health? Health is social, mental, and physical well-being. And not merely disease or infirmities, yes or not? Yes, of course. It means about happiness. Generally, when we are speaking to each other, we are wishing in your health, yes? It's very bad to drink in your health. It's better to celebrate saying for your health, because we can do much more. Because, you know, I remember our second lifestyle medicine conference meeting here in Countdowns in 18th of March 2016. If I may, I will quote a little bit, because it is very important to see where we are now. Then we decided, yes, therefore, the participants of Lifestyle Medicine Conference call Lithuanian health policymakers, I see Aurelius, my friend Veriga, to develop new and innovative solutions that would enable more efficient and effective methods to address emerging healthcare challenges. Let's think about emerging healthcare challenges. Second, invite health policymakers. It means Aurelius and me, to support and encourage training and education of lifestyle medicine specialists, as well as introduce systematic and political solutions that would support the integration of lifestyle medicine specialists into existing individual and public health system, including the acceleration of the services of regulation, licensing, and financing. We just talk a little bit about certification and all issues. Then ask political leaders at the municipalities to support further development of public health services oriented not only to the health of community but of the individual as well, and call NGOs to take more responsibility in the promotion of healthy lifestyle at the community level. Who will be against? Although those very excellent conclusions. And now I would like to tell you, for me it's very important once again to remember, I am very happy to look around the world and to see good examples. In my hands I have National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey, 1999-2016, survey content brochure. It was done by National Center for Health Statistics, United States. They have a lot of data. There are a lot of excellent scientific-based arguments describing common picture of our population. It will be good to have such data in every country. Aurelius, what do you think about? I think it will be very nice to have such possibilities to propose to our society from the beginning, you know, to have passport of health. Health, about health status. It will be good to have that every child will have the right to have passport about speaking about, not about sickness, about diseases, but about health resources, about status of health. And of course, then we need to have instruments, we need to have specialists, we need to have evidence-based solutions. Why today we are speaking about a situation related to health promotion, disease prevention? Okay, friends, if I may to ask you big pardon and to say a few words in Lithuanian, okay? You may you not against, because you know I am here, I would like to speak a little bit on my mother tongue, okay? Okay. And of course I can try to be to quick as possible, but let's us discuss a little bit about issues. Aš norėčiau dabar truputį pasižiūrėti iš labai bendros pozicijos, iš bendro portreto, kuris išties yra labai svarbus. Ministras Aurelijus Veryga tikrai žino, kad mes pateikėm kaip Europos komisija, pirmą kartą mes pateikėm visų 28 ES šalių narių sveikatos profilius. State of health in the EU, health profiles of every country. Ir taip pat pateikėme didžiulį lydintį raportą, aprašydami parametrus. Bet aš noriu atkreipti dėmesį, kad čia mes kalbėsime ne apie tai, ką aš minėjau apie sveikatos išteklius, apie sveikatos resursus, ar apie galimybę monitoruoti sveikatos resursus, jos gausinti, stiprinti ir tuo būdu mėginti įtikinti, kad gyvensenos medicina yra tai, kas padeda mums išlaikyti žmogų kiek galima ilgiau sveikatoje. Sveikatoje. Bet ši čia yra truputį kitas reikalas apie bendrą vaizdą. Tai kaip matote, čia apie kaštus gydymui ir kaštus prevencijai. Mes šį rytą šiek tiek kalbėjome apie kaštus gydymui ir kaštus prevencijai. Aišku, jeigu tokia tendencija vystysis toliau, šitie skaičiai kalba apie ilgą laikę politiką. Kaip pakeisti visus mechanizmus, kad investicijos į sveikatos ugdymą, išlaikymą, tobulinimą, sveikos gyvensenos įdiegimą ir stiprinimą, tos investicijos, tarkim, per 15 metų pasikeistų į skirtingą proporciją, galvojant apie tai, kad, na, kad 30% pasiekti investicijų į sveikatos reikalus, sumažinant atitinkamai dalį skiriamą lygų gydymui. Mes visi žinome, kokie portretai yra pasaulyje. Šiandien mes kalbame apie civilizacijos lygas, civilizacijos, nutukimo skaičiai, nesveika mityba, alkoholio suvartojimas. Aš žinau, kiek daug skausmo yra mūsų ministro Verygos akise ir politinio skausmo. Nes tie mūšiai, kurie čia vyksta, jie turi labai daug tokio, kaip sakyti, lobistinio įkarščio, kuris nepadeda suprasti, apie ką eina kalba. Nes populiacinio portreto supratimas yra menkas Lietuvoje. Gerai, žiūrėkime į tai, kaip mes priklausom nuo alkoholio suvartojimo. Ir čia man kaip komisarui iš Lietuvos reikia pasakyti, kad aš būnu panašios spalvos, kaip čia yra pavaizduota. Mano žandai visą laiką būna raudoni, kai aš turiu kalbėti apie alkoholio suvartojimo problemas ir negaliu niekaip suprasti, kodėl mes čia. Dabar žvilgtelkime į tabaką. Vėlgi suprantame, kad žinoma, čia raudonumo yra daugiau, ačiū Dievui, mes čia, kaip sakyti, jau taip galim patogiau jaustis truputį, bet aš visą laiką mėgstu pabrėžti Europos Sąjungoje visiems mano kolegoms, partneriams, kad kai mane skyrė komisaru, aš pateikiau 4 paprastas raides, 4 P. Prevention, promotion, protection, 3 P. Ir 4 P pasakiau participation. įtraukimas, įtraukimas. Kodėl? Todėl, kad čia šiandien mes kalbėsime apie gyvensenos mediciną ir apie galimybės mūsų sveikatos apsaugos sistemai matyti kolegas, kurie dediko savo gyvenimą sveikos gyvensenos koreliacijoms. Jos yra labai sunkios. Čia yra labai sunki profesija. Kaip sakyt, kuri reikalaus labai daug jėgų. Bet problema yra kita. Sveikatos problematika slypi už sveikatos įstaigų tinklo ribų, už gydymo įstaigų ribų. Sveikatos problemos šiandien yra visur. Jos turi būti sprendžiamas visų švietimo sistemoje, socialinėje sistemoje, transporto sistemoje, miestų planavimo sistemoje, savivaldybių infrastruktūros plėtros sistemoje ir daugelį kitų. Ir taip pat maisto industrijoje ir parduotuvėse pagaliau. Kaip sakant, kad mes kartuojame health in all political sectors, arba sveikata visose politikose, mes kalbame apie tą raidę P, participation, apie tą įtraukti į sveikatos politikas tų kitų sektorių ir tų kitų dalyvių, ir tų politikų, ir tų ministrų, ir tų Seimo narių, kurie privalo suvokti priešingų atvejų tas dominantė pinigų skiriamų lygų gydymui su dominantė skiriama pinigų prevencijai, kaip sakyti, sveikatos stiprinimui, profilaktikai ir įtraukčiai. Jį daug ką pasako. Bet čia aš kalbu apie populiacinį public health portretą. Ir apie populiacinius instrumentus. Bet kaip mes einam į individualų kelią, į kiekvieną žmogų, mes tuomet puikiai susidurėme, kad su kiekvienu žmogumi, norint įtikinti jį, kad sveikatos išteklių savo įsvaldytų, reikia tą žmogų nuo pat lopšio ugdyti. Ir štai kodėl aš čia kalbant vėlgi apie tos instrumentus, kuriuos mes galime pritaikyti, kad sveikatos politikos įgyvendinimo receptai įvairiuose sektoriuose būtų išrašyti ir tvarkomi ir jie būtų ilgalaikiai. Čia suprantama, puikiai žinom, kad tai yra mokestinė politika, tai yra kainų politika, tai yra marketingo politika, tai yra daugelis kitų dalykų. Šiandien mes visi kalbame apie determinacijas. Rizikos veiksnius ir kaip juos suvaldyti. Bet pačios baisiausios determinacijos, kurios iš esmės atakuoja mūsų vaikus, paauglius ir jaunimą ir suaugusius, kai mes matome begalės rizikos veiksnių, tos determinacijos yra komercinės. Komercinės determinacijos. Pamėginkit įtikinti, kad mūsų supermarketai nedėliotų tabako prie kasų, kad būtų vis, nes kodėl prie kasų, lengva nusipirkti. Nedėliotų saldumynų vaikų ir paauglių lygyje, akių lygyje, lentynuose, kodėl? Lengva prieiti ir sugundyti. Nedėliotų alkoholinių gėrimų prieinamai, kodėl? Greitą nusipirkti ir greitai išgerti. Visa tai yra pelnas vartotojų sistemos, kaip sakyti, esminė dalis, tai yra parduoti rizikos veiksnius kuo pigiau, kuo greičiau, kuo efektyviau ir plius milžiniška sveikatai kenksminga reklamos agresija. Ir tada mes turime milžinišką aplinką civilizacinių faktorių, kurie paveikia mūsų vaikus, kurie sukelia gyvensenos krizę. Ir ta gyvensenos krizė nuo pat mažų dienų dabar lydi. Ir jeigu vaikas jau 12-13 metų yra ir susiformavo jo, kaip sakyti, refleksai ir jo supratimas ir jo polinkiai, tuomet gyvensenos specialistui pakeisti jo, kaip sakyti, behavioral determinants yra labai sunku. Vadinasi, ankstyvoj veikloj gyvensenos problemos jau turi būti. Ir tos gyvensenos problemos turi būti monitoruojamos, stebimos, koreguojamos. Štai kodėl aš kalbu apie tą vaikų sveikatos pasą ir galimybės monitoruoti mūsų vaikųčių raidą, ne tik brandą, bet ir jų įpročių raidą. Ir tai, kaip jie susiformuoja iki 15-20 metų. Jeigu čia mes nedėsim daug pastangų, mes neturėsime galimybių pasiekti rezultatų to, apie ką kalbam, kad žymiai didesnė dalis mūsų augančios kartos būtų išlaikoma sveikatoje kiek galima ilgiau, su kiek galima stipresnių individualių apsisprendimų po 18 metų tęsti sveikatos gyvensenos pagrindus. Štai kodėl aš manau, kad šitą skaidrį aš praleisiu, jau pasakiau. Štai kodėl mes kalbame apie tai, kad gyvensenos medicinos profesija dabar yra ypatingai svarbi Lietuvai ir pasauliai. Tikėkit manim. Šiandien mes gerai atrodom, kada mes įvedėme Public Health fakultetą ir įvedėm šiandien visuomenės sveikatos biurus ir jau rengiam specialistus, kurie gali naudoti įvairius instrumentus, populiacinius instrumentus, reguliuoti visuomenės sveikatos iššūkius populiacijos mastu, bet individualiai. Einant į kiekvieną konkretų asmenį, personalizuojant gyvensenos mediciną, mums aišku reikia turėti gyvensenos specialistus. Vadinasi, mes galime matyti, kad mes turime bendrosios praktikos gydytojus, įvairių specialybių gydytojus, specializacijas, sveikatos lygų gydymo sistemą su specialistais. Toliau mes turime tarp bendros praktikos gydytojų turime visuomenės sveikatos specialistus, kurie turėtų daryti didžiulius darbus, populiacinius, toj nematomai didžiuliai mūsų erdvė. Ir pagaliau, trūkstama grandis, lifestyle medicine, trūkstanta grandis yra tai, apie ką šiandien mes kalbam. Ir čia iškyla problema ir mums. Kaip mes galime įvesti gyvensenos sveikatos specialybę į sveikatos sistemą? Kaip mes galime įvesti tą specialybę į kitas sistemas, į švietimo sistemą ir kaip mes galime užtikrinti darbo vietas, kaip mes galime aptarti finansavimo dalykus ir kaip mes galime diskutuoti apie tai, kad jeigu sveikos gyvensenos receptas išrašomas žmogui, kaip finansiškai kompensuoti. Dabar vyksta diskusijos Vokietijoje, kad galima ligonių kasų sutinka jau kompensuoti fizinio aktyvumo prirašytą receptą ligoniui, kad jis jį naudotų ir kad tai būtų apmokėta iš ligonių kasų. Vadinasi, jeigu kalbame apie gyvensenos medicinos, visą kompleksą, kurį jie gali pateikti konkrečiam individualiam žmogui, problema kaip tamet kompensuoti tą vadinamą įgydymą. Ir čia yra iš tikrųjų labai rimti klausimai susiję su to vadinamu politikos formavimu, politinių lyderių apsisprendimu ir mūsų visuomenės sveikatos ir gyvensenos sveikatos medikų diskusijomis, kaip įvesti tai į visą mūsų sveikatinimo veiklos grandinę. Aš labai džiaugiuosi, kad mes komisijoje ėmėme kreipti dėmesį į prevenciją, profilaktiką ir kitus dalykus ir įsteigėm tai vadinamą, matot, steering group on promotion and prevention. Mūsų tikslas yra sukaupti visą specialistų pajėgas, suformuoti, kaip sakyt, platformą, naudojant IT technologijas ir pateikti galimus geriausios praktikos pavyzdžius ir pateikti galimas kaip sakyt, siūlomus būdus, kad tos būdus šalis narės galėtų diskutuoti ir galėtų įgyvendinti. Ir aš manau, kad Lietuvos pastangos judėti sveikos gyvensenos medicinos kryptimi, jos galėtų atsirasti šitoj grupiai kaip nagrinėjamos ir kaip galimybė dalintis šitom iniciatyvomis su visom 27 valstybėm. Ačiū jums labai, dovanokit už mano gal karštą kalbą, bet aš labai tikiu, kad mes judėsim toliau į priekį ir pamėginsime iš tikrųjų diskutuoti ir apie tai, kaip sveikatinimo ir sveikatinimo specialistus įtraukti į valstybinės sistemas, kurios būtų finansuojamas, nes darbo vietos turi būti apmokamas. Aš manau, kad Nacionalinė sveikatos taryba, nežinau, šiandien kažkodėl diskutuoja apie jos likvidavimą, čia būtų visiškas nesusipratimas mano galva, nes nacionalinė, nes sveikatos ministerija turėtų būti dedikuota lygų gydymui, lygų profilaktikai, lygų prevencijai. Ir kolegos, bendros praktikos daktarai arba kardiochirurgai ar psichiatrai iš tikrųjų neturi laiko galimybių, kaip sakyti, užsiimti be galo sudėtingą gyvensenos keitimo ir gydymo problematiką. Tai štai Nacionalinė sveikatos taryba, jos funkcijos būtų sveikatinimo problemų vadyba, įgyvendinimas, monitoravimas, įtraukiant visus aktorius, NGO'sus, kaip sakyt, profsąjungas, savivaldybės, asociacijas, ją reiktų paversti Nacionalinę sveikatos tarybą, valiologijos struktūrą, kuri rūpintųsi sveikatinimo, sveikos gyvensinos ir to pačiu įgyvendinimu pasaulio sveikatos organizacijos sveikatos apibrėžimo. Nes sveikata, kaip matėte, nieko bendro su lygom neturi. Ministrė, darom.
Thank you indeed, Commissioner, for your inspiring speech and very constructive information which was provided. Thank you. I think everyone heard very promising ideas from you. I hope it will come true. And now I welcome on the stage Minister of Health of Lithuania, Professor Aurelius Veryga, who, by the way, for those who do not know, he was the first coordinator of Lifestyle Medicine Master Program at our university.
Good morning, dear Commissioner, Vice Rector, Director General, dear guests from abroad, colleagues from Parliament, students, professors. It is a pleasure to be here in this auditorium and see this program not only survived, but consistently growing and getting more and more interest also in other universities. And it shows that more and more academics understand that probably this is a good attempt and this is a good chance for Lithuania to introduce something new, not only for Lithuania, but also for the rest of the world. And it's never easy to be a pioneer. It was never easy. And I'm looking to some professors sitting here in this auditorium. They know for sure how uneasy it was to start to talk about the public health itself when the world was concentrating mostly on the clinical research, on the disease treatment. So there were professionals that were brave at that time to introduce the real public health that now we have no discussions on the risk factors. And we are not questioning those risk factors that the commissioner just presented that has biggest influence on our health globally. Nutrition, smoking, alcohol consumption, physical activity. But some decades that was not a natural understanding. And it took years for the researchers to prove this is true. So now we are looking for the solutions. So I would like to thank University and Association of Lifestyle Medicine and the Dean and the University for this conference, consistently introducing the new things, bringing us together to discuss about the future of lifestyle medicine. And I would like to tell a bit about policy development in Lithuania in the public health. And as the commissioner mentioned, that was a tough time. That was really a tough time. You know, when you come from an academic environment and you are adjusted to work with constructive professors that have discussions based on, you know, research papers, and you have very ethical discussions at the university. When you come to the politics, it's nothing like that. And it's really, really true when somebody says that people would not like to know how the sausages and politics are made. So this is really true, but finally we succeeded with the, I would say, with the very, very important developments. And the alcohol control policy was adopted in the parliament. And I'm happy to say that now we have things that the WHO was proposing for so many years. And this is, again, a case story for the whole of the world, because there was no single country like Lithuania that would introduce so many policy measures at the same time. So now the ministry and the university and the WHO is working together with the researchers to evaluate this, because we need a real research to tell how it works, to show that that the rest of the countries can follow Lithuanian example. So it's not easy to be a pioneer, but it's such a good feeling when you move at least one step forward. I'm happy to say that there is a development in food policy also, because we succeeded to come to agreement with the food production industry on the reduction of salt, sugar, fat levels in the food products. So it means that you know, when we talk about the behavioral change, it usually is not easy for us as a human beings to change the behavior. But when the food producers will change the food products, there will be no need to change behavior, because when you eat the same products, you are getting less sugar, less salt, and you are getting less risk for your own health. So this is a big achievement. We are monitoring how we will succeed with this, but we are happy that the food industry came to the table and agreed on the reductions of those food supplements. So this is one thing. And there was a development that finally will lead Lithuania to food policy without trans fats, and this will be not up to the choice. This will be obligatory. So again, without any need to change the behavior, people will eat the healthier food, and this is again very serious. We are trying to take serious steps to promote physical activities, and especially in the high schools. And in my opinion, we have to create an environment when the high schools would be motivated by, first of all, parents to be serious about health promotion, physical activity, and nutrition in the schools. And you remember how seriously parents were taking those so-called the ranking of the schools, when everyone now can see where is the school according to the exams, how children are finishing the school, how successful they are by entering universities. So we have an idea to rank schools according to the health, and to show every parent that this or this school and this and that child is in this and that level according to other schools, just to motivate them to pay attention to the health promotion. And we are working very closely with the Ministry of Education to have this ranking mechanism to stimulate the schools to be serious about the health. What else? It is very, very important now for you and for us to build the trust about this profession. The ministry is moving forward. Now we have a description of this profession. And this is another step to introduce that into the system. And as Commissioner mentioned, we have to create the mechanism how to introduce those specialists into the group of family practitioners, how they will work together, how to allocate the finances. But this is not the most complicated question. We can find the finances, but there has to be a trust, because we are lacking trust in many other areas. Doctors don't trust nurses, psychiatrists don't trust psychologists, and it is very, very natural that at the very beginning, some doctors and health professionals will not really trust those new specialists in lifestyle medicine. But take it as a challenge, because if you will prove that this profession really helps a family practitioners to deal with those most serious risk factors, they finally will look for you themselves, because you know that the payment is associated with the number of people that are connected to the family practitioner. So it is better for the family practitioner that people are less ill. They are getting the same money without less spending. So when they will discover that the health, those new professionals, they are helping them to keep the population healthier, they will be motivated themselves to invite you to work together. So be brave, continue to work on this program. Nobody is perfect. There is always a room for more perfection. And thank you for those coming from different countries to help Lithuania to improve or develop the curriculum. And have a good, interesting, and productive conference.
Thank you, Minister. I hope we will succeed with support of you and other important persons. So I just want to tell you that last week we had very interesting session of real practical implementation of lifestyle medicine into the practice, and our graduates and our students were working in real practical environment with support of leading professionals in Druskininkai. And one of our dear friends, Brenda Davis, who is the world famous nutritionist, she was working there, but she couldn't come today here with us because she had to go to South America to continue the duties there. So as far as I know, Brenda sent to us her welcoming speech, and if we could hear it, please.
Good morning. My name is Brenda Davis. I'm from Kelowna, British Columbia, Canada, and it is with great regrets that I'm not with you for the fourth annual Lifestyle Medicine Conference. I'm very excited about the conference. I was just here in Lithuania to be part of the first lifestyle intervention at UPA. And it was just a tremendous experience. We put 10 people through a lifestyle intervention program and watched their transformation from ill health to much better health. For many of them, evidenced by lab results that were quite impressive. And I am so excited about Lithuania and the efforts that have been made to make this possible. I truly believe that Lithuania has the potential, the opportunity to become sort of the center, the epicenter of lifestyle medicine, and not just a leader, but really the leader globally. And this is because of the climate within the sort of political world of Lithuania for lifestyle medicine. And why lifestyle medicine? Well, what we're seeing is an epidemic, a tsunami of chronic disease globally that is responsible for about 70% of the deaths on this planet. And the way that medicine has treated these chronic diseases to date really is by putting a Band-Aid on people, by treating the symptoms of the disease rather than to treat the cause of the disease. In lifestyle medicine, we're treating the cause of the disease. We're getting to the basically lifestyle diseases are because of the way we eat, because of the way we move, because of smoking, because of drinking. These are the four main factors. When we address those factors, we see remarkable reversal of disease. I can tell you from patients that I've worked with, from people that have experienced using lifestyle medicine as a treatment, that you can completely, in many cases, reverse disease, especially diabetes, heart disease, and sometimes other chronic diseases as well, including some types of cancer. So this is something we need to take seriously. It's really time that we recognize the immense power of lifestyle medicine for treating chronic disease. And I congratulate you all for being here, for the organizers of this conference. This is really the beginning of many more to come, and I wish you all the best for this day and for the future. Thank you so much for having me.
So we all thank Brenda Davis, and I'm sure we will pass our greetings to her. And now I also want to inform you that in recent years we have been working very closely with International Board of Lifestyle Medicine. And last year our program of lifestyle medicine has been acknowledged as meeting international requirements, and our graduates as meeting competencies required to sit on the licensing exam organized by International Board of Lifestyle Medicine, which opens them the way and the gate worldwide to work as lifestyle medicine professionals. So I'm very happy for this achievement. And now I will invite here a director of International Board of Lifestyle Medicine, Stefan Herzog, to present his talk. Stefan.
Thank you very much. Can I get you all to stand up, please? Just stand up, because you know that sitting is the new smoking, right? You've all read the research that prolonged periods of sitting is as harmful as smoking 2 or 3 or 4 cigarettes a day. So whenever we sit for a long time, stand up, stretch, stand as long as you like. For the rest of you who, okay, we can sit down again. I actually would like to address a personal view. Please sit down. A personal view on the idea of how to implement lifestyle medicine. I put a contention to you that lifestyle medicine should not be a specialty. Lifestyle medicine should be what we do. We all eat, don't we? Eating is not special. Eating is what we do at least 3 times a day. So knowing how to eat to keep us at the best we can be should be knowledge that everybody has, not just specialists. When we move our bodies, we all know how to move, so that's something that we should all know. And so while, of course, there is this place for lifestyle medicine specialists in the world, our desire for the International Board of Lifestyle Medicine is actually to make lifestyle medicine a core competence for every human being on Earth. And the way we go there is obviously through the medical profession to go and evangelize the world on that it's actually not about popping a pill, but if you put the right foods in here and you move properly, your life, you can be the best you can be. Does that make sense? And so that's kind of why the lifestyle medicine, there is obviously clearly, I want to just remind you of the numbers. 80% of the cost of medical care is through lifestyle, it's through chronic disease. And 80% of chronic disease is driven by the lifestyles we lead. 10% is your environment, and another 10% is genetics. And John Kelly, who comes after me, will talk to you about the science of genetics. Now, if you look, I don't know, you don't have to really see it from down there, but the biggest number is the US of A, and these days it's already gone above $10,000 per person medical expenditure per annum. In Lithuania, it's about $1,000 per person per annum. So what we obviously want to do here is to avoid the tsunami that's inevitably coming. So while in the US, prevention has long ceased to be effective, because we are now in the cure mode. We have to actually fix the damage done. Here, we're at the beginning of the damage, and if we spend our time on prevention, we'll have to spend a little bit less time on the cure, right? So this is what we want to prevent, but I want to remind you of the personal cost of ill health, because some of us who are older, right, we start to see how it affects us. Some of us who are younger, we have parents who get affected by this. In a country where cardiovascular disease is the number one cause of, obviously, chronic disease, and when you remember that 40%, for 40% of the people, the first sign of ill health in terms of chronic disease is sudden death. And if that person is your mom, that person is your dad, right, then it starts to hit home. And so I just want to remind all of us that this is not just about the hard, cold facts of reducing cost. This is actually about leading the best lives we possibly can and do so in the best health we can possibly muster. And because the deck is completely stacked against us, every advertising you see out there, right, it's all about more fast food, more calories, more empty calories, more fat, sugar, and salt, as we heard from the Commissioner of Health. This is just the way life at the moment is. And so it's up to us to start to counterbalance this. I hope that makes sense, right? So if I were to be asked to grade the medical profession today, I would say that in terms of acute care, it's absolutely brilliant. If you walk out the front here and you slip on the snow and you break your arm, modern medicine can put you back together better than when you before, right? It's absolutely miraculous. The way we can cut open people, the way you can transplant stuff, we're absolutely brilliant in terms of acute care. When it comes to communicable disease, we're equally brilliant, because there's no mumps, there is no measles, there is no diphtheria, there is no polio, there is no leprosy, it's disappeared, right? When it comes to chronic disease, unfortunately, as we just heard Brenda say, we're actually pretty poor. I reckon we get an F in the US and probably about a 2 here in Lithuania. And the reason for this is because the way we've eliminated communicable disease and combated communicable disease is through diagnosing and prescribing. You're familiar with that, right? That's what our profession is, diagnosing and prescribing. Unfortunately, chronic disease doesn't respond to that. Let me show you. Most people in medical schools, most medical professionals spent all of their lives in the top two part of this triangle. We learn how to do surgery, we learn how to diagnose, we learn how to prescribe. That is where we spend all our time and energy and effort. And so it's not because we don't want to be good at chronic disease management, chronic disease reversal. It's simply that we don't get taught. Present company excluded, most physicians in their 6-year university education have between 4 and 6 hours of nutritional education. And most of that is spent on learning what's the difference between a carbohydrate and a protein, right? But we don't actually learn the cause and effects of food. We don't learn about the cause and effects of movement. We don't learn about the cause and effects of stress, of sleep, of connectedness to each other. We don't. So again, we're not blaming anybody, but I think it's for us, it's really time to re-educate the medical profession and say, hey, there is more to this treatment. When you look at the bottom, lifestyle medicine is truly the first defense line in terms of treating chronic disease. Because although Brenda referred to obviously smoking and nourishment, we actually don't call it even the food, we call it nourishment. Right? Anything that you put into your mouth, what you drink, what you eat, even the substances that you put into your mouth, it's all part of nourishment. You have movement. It's not just exercise, because for most people, particularly when you're chronically diseased, you say exercise and they all want to go die, right? Because people don't associate exercise with something positive. They don't understand the release of endorphins that when we start to exercise, it becomes an enjoyable habit, right, Petras? You know, it's very important that we kind of understand that, right? Resilience. This is about stress. You people who are here on studying, you know what stress is like, right? Sitting up all night studying for the exams, learning, cramming, doing stuff, right? It's very important that we understand the relationship between good health and stress. It's very important that we understand the relationship between sleep and good health. So resilience is all part of the rest, relaxation, the stress. And then there is what we call connectedness. Because the way we're connected to each other, our relationships that we have, there is plenty of evidence out there, scientific evidence that shows that people who've got healthy relationships are also healthier physically. And although we live in the Facebook age, right? And the more likes we have on Facebook, the more lonely we usually are in real life. And our own relationships are suffering. But it's not just the horizontal connectedness that research has shown that is really important. For those of us who believe in a higher power, it's actually our connectedness to the higher power that is really important in terms of our health, right? Whatever that higher power for you is, right? And so when you look at that triangle, the first line of defense is truly lifestyle medicine. The physiology part, this is what we call functional medicine and integrative medicine. Are these terms that we're familiar here with here in Lithuania? Yes. Right? Now, we don't call lifestyle medicine alternative medicine. And I want to be really, really clear about that. Alternative medicines are medicines that are usually classified where the evidence base is really weak and it's not corroborated. So you're talking about naturopathy, you're talking about homeopathy, you're talking about Ayurvedic medicine, you're talking about transcendental meditation, all of that stuff that people might or might not believe in, but it's more a belief thing than an evidence thing. So lifestyle medicine specifically excludes those things and say we're in the evidence-based house of medicine. So the physiology bit, when you talk about integrative medicine, let me make a simple example. If you were to be diagnosed with vitamin C deficiency, what would be a really good lifestyle medicine intervention? Eating an orange, right? Eating 2 oranges, eating oranges every day, right? Now for 80% of the people, that will fix the vitamin C deficiency. Now if you are a special, right, and you might not get your vitamin C levels to the way they need to be, you might go to a nutraceutical, which is the next level up to physiology, right? You might go and see whether you can pop some vitamin pills in addition to your oranges. But lifestyle medicine says before you pop the vitamin pill, eat the orange. Does that make sense? right? And even if then that doesn't work, you might go up the food chain and look, might be there might be some pharmaceuticals that might help you. But that's kind of the last line of defense. It's not the first line of defense. Does that kind of make sense? The important thing is also the right-hand side there, because lifestyle medicine interventions are low cost. If I prescribe to somebody when they have chronic inflammation, if you prescribe broccoli, that's actually really cheap. Or if somebody wants to know what's the best source of protein is, if we prescribe beans, I'm sure even in Lithuania, beans are cheaper than meat, right? So when you look at the risk and we look at the cost, lifestyle medicine actually is the cheap version, right? And the further up the chain we go, the further up the triangle, the more expensive it gets. Does that make sense? All right, let's move on. So, here's some global lifestyle medicine hotspots. Clearly, you're familiar with the concept of the blue zones, the 8 places on Earth where research has shown that people live on average 10 years longer. One of them is obviously Loma Linda, California, right? And so that's clearly one of the hotspots. There is Athens, Ohio, which is, again, a university town, a university that has embraced lifestyle medicine. The School of Osteopathy is obviously teaching their people, and there is a lot of CHIP activity. CHIP is a complete health improvement program. It's an intensive therapeutic lifestyle change program that is very, very efficacious out there. But it's also the home of where most of the pioneers of lifestyle medicine are at. And I don't mean to tell you how fortunate you are, but you actually have two of the people, the leading people in lifestyle medicine here in the room, right? We have John Kelly, we have Hans Diehl. These people have come here, and I kid you not, they're actually recognized all around the world as the leaders in lifestyle medicine, together obviously with Dean Ornish and Caldwell Esselstyn, and you're familiar with the China study, right, from Colin Campbell. So this is one of the hotspots. Australia is one of the hotspots because there is a fellowship in lifestyle medicine at Avondale University and at Southern Cross University. There is also Professor Gary Egger, who's been writing about lifestyle medicine for a very, very long time. We have Manila in the Philippines, which is a very unusual place, right? But the Manila Adventist Hospital has adopted this CHIP program, and they're literally putting hundreds and hundreds of people through the program. And you wouldn't accuse Manila to be or the Philippines to be a developed country, right? It's actually these people are not loaded with money, but they suffer from the same issues as everybody else does, because the funny thing is in Asia, right? We all know, who thinks white rice or brown rice? Let me see, who is for brown rice in terms of health, who is for white rice? Right, brown rice, yes, that's the healthy bit, right? Where all the goodness is still there, all the fiber is still there, right? Did you know that in Asia, brown rice is for the poor people? And I happened in my spare time, I look after an orphanage in Burma. Now we're talking Burma, the poorest of the poor countries in Asia, and orphans, the poorest of the poor in the poorest of the poor countries. Guess what they tell me? But Stefan, we're not that poor that we have to eat brown rice. The mindset is completely screwed. It's not their own fault, but that's what you combat. So in Manila, the same mindset prevails. And so particularly diabetes is absolutely rampant. And so people have adopted this intensive therapeutic lifestyle change, and off they go. It changes a city, it changes a nation. We have Lima, and we have Sao Paulo in South America. And then we have Kaunas. And you know, when people go to a concert, right? And Robbie Williams comes to Vilnius and he says Kaunas, and Kaunas is the most beautiful town in the world. You know they're just being nice, right? You know that, right? It's not because Kaunas is not beautiful, but you know, they say that in New York, and they say that in Sao Paulo, and they say that everywhere, right? This is actually the truth. And I'll show you why. This is the website of the International Board of Lifestyle Medicine and the American Board of Lifestyle Medicine. It might be a bit hard to read from there, but can you see that this is all of the approved educational programs to lead you to international certification. We have the Black Hills program that is John Kelly is running. We have the Masters of Lifestyle Medicine at Kaunas University in Lithuania. Can you see any other international thing there? It doesn't exist. So you people are truly pioneers, right? You truly, truly are. And it's marvelous to see. When you look at lifestyle medicine certification, so we run certifications on all the places where people are willing and people have reached a certain level of understanding that this is actually not voodoo, that this is the real thing, right? And in 12 months from now, in this very place, we will run the first lifestyle medicine certification program in this country. So you people can become officially certified lifestyle medicine practitioners. So here is the global vision for lifestyle medicine. We want to remain firmly in the house of medicine. The reason why we say this is because there is obviously certain tendencies to say, well, you know, like veganism. Now, I don't know about this country, but when you hear vegan or vegetarian around the world, people think ideology. They don't hear health. They hear, oh, you know, I'm gonna not kill the animals, it's global warming, I'm gonna chain myself to redwood in California so they can't cut it. And I'm not saying they're not necessarily worthy causes. I'm simply saying in order for lifestyle medicine to remain scientific, we stay in the house of medicine, and this is about the best health we can be, the healthiest we can be rather than anything else. The second thing is we want to continue to be evidence-based. And that's why we don't consider ourselves to be alternative medicine, we're mainstream medicine, because we're evidence-based. We want to coordinate our activities internationally. We want to syndicate programs and certifications. We don't want people to do all their things individually, because you know here, when you finish as a physician from Kaunas University, can you go practice in Australia? No, because guess what the Australians say? Oh, no, no, we're really special, and how do we know that you're learning the right things in Lithuania, right? And if you're a physician from the US and you want to practice in Lithuania, what do the Lithuanians say? Oh, no, 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 you got to jump through many, many hoops, because we don't know whether you learned the right thing in the US. And so everybody has developed their own little silos, which is really hard to overcome. But because lifestyle medicines is a new discipline, we have an opportunity to build a global platform right off the bat where everybody coordinates and everybody works together. Sharing of resources, and obviously again, the first protocol for treatment. From an organizational point of view, it's a little bit, this looks a little bit of a busy slide, but I just hope you get it. In the US, we had this special thing that we have to separate the certifying bodies from the educational bodies. So we had to have an American College of Lifestyle Medicine on the very far left, and we had to have an American Board of Lifestyle Medicine, which are meant to be separate entities. Which then also, when you internationalize this, then we created the Lifestyle Medicine Global Alliance and the International Board of Lifestyle Medicine. And underneath these, we have the European Lifestyle Medicine Organization, we have the Asian Society of Lifestyle Medicine, the Latin American Society Lifestyle Medicine Association, the Australasian Society of Lifestyle Medicine, and Africa. And you're going to hear from Ify later on today. Africa will be hopefully one day on the list there too. And then obviously under ELMO, under the European Lifestyle Medicine Organization, you have Lithuania, you have the Brits, you have the Italians, you have the Deutsche Gemeinschaft für Lebensstilmedizin. These are all people who have already been organized, and as more countries get organized, they all obviously fall under this platform. So from a certification, where we're at today is that we actually have the same prerequisites all over the world. So the people who are going to sign up for certification here in Lithuania, they have to meet the same requirement as the people in the US. They have to meet the same requirements as the people in South America. We just ran a lifestyle medicine certification in Manila, right? They had the very same prerequisites. We have the same pricing everywhere. Clearly, we did an adjustment in pricing as far as, you've heard of the Big Mac Index? Right? So kind of parity in terms of purchasing power. So clearly it wouldn't be right for a physician, you know, a physician in the US might earn $300,000 per annum, right? But the same physician in Manila might earn $30,000 per annum or $50,000. It wouldn't be right to charge him the same in terms of certification. So we obviously adjust the certifications according to the purchasing power, so we have parity. Right, but it's basically the same pricing in terms of how much the size of hole it burns into my pocket, so to speak. Right, we have the same exam. The exam is proctored all over the world. It's the very same exam, the same questions. We have the same proctoring. We have the same scoring. We have the same pass rates. So that when you are certified, then you really, really know that you're the same as everybody else on earth. Now, here's the exciting thing. There is already companies around the world who say our employees need to be treated by people, by physicians who understand lifestyle medicine, who have been taught in lifestyle medicine. I shared in our break before, Cummins Diesel. Cummins is one of the world's largest producers of diesel engines for trucks, right? Cummins Diesel have determined that every physician who looks after their employees, and there is 120,000 around the world, must be lifestyle medicine certified. So in our first certification that we had only last year in Tucson, right, that was a global first, we had about 12 physicians of Premise Health, who is the people who got the contract to look after Cummins, to be lifestyle medicine certified. Adrian Kennedy will share with you later about what's happening in the Middle East. There will be a great, great need for lifestyle medicine certified physicians and health practitioners around the world very, very soon. And if you are here and you're trained, the world's your oyster. Because as a world first, you have a certification that's completely and utterly transportable globally, right? No more further hoops to jump through. Just quick, the way we're organized. So each, the international board has got the director of the local lifestyle medicine society. They're always part of the international board, ex officio. So this is not a US driven thing. This is a global thing. So the Asians have got a seat on the board. The Europeans have a seat on the board. The South Americans, the Africans, eventually the people in Oceania. And then we have some elected people. And obviously the director of the Lifestyle Medicine Global Alliance is also part of this. So again, it's really important that the right hand always knows what the left hand is doing. Which leads me to a slightly controversial thing. So I don't mean to step on any toes, but one of the challenges that I see that you people have here in Lithuania is that you currently have two lifestyle medicine organizations. I don't know whether you're aware of that, but the people who are aware, that's something that we need to address. Because we need to fight chronic disease, not each other. And so I would strongly encourage you people to play nice. Somebody once said that if ego and pride take a back seat, 95% of the problems on earth can be solved just like that, right? And so I just encourage you to work towards unity so we can go and slay the dragon called chronic disease, right? The certification is twofold. We have certified lifestyle medicine physicians. You must be a physician in your country in order to be eligible to sit for that. You must provide your physician credentials. You have 30 hours of online CME that you must complete, and you have 10 hours of in-person CME that you must complete. Now again, if you do your lifestyle medicine master's at Kaunas University, that's all taken care of. That's part of your education. You don't have to jump through those extra hoops. As a physician, you also have to provide a case study. Here is the time when I used lifestyle medicine intervention to make a difference in this person's life. And then you're being certified by your country lifestyle medicine organization. by the European Lifestyle Medicine Organization and the International Board of Lifestyle Medicine. We have a second, and the exam is 150 multiple choice questions. We have the PhD and Masters, where you are then a certified lifestyle medicine professional. You also have 30 hours of CME, 10 hours of in-person CME. The case study falls away, and it's a 120 item exam. And again, the certifications are issued. Let me just quickly show you. And again, I just picked one of the two competing Lifestyle Medicine Associations to put their logos on, but that's actually what you're gonna get when we're done, right? So let me quickly go back here. So where we're at the moment is the exams have been produced, prerequisites have been established, we have the equivalency pathways created, we have agreements between the IBLM and the local Lifestyle Medicine Associations, we have the website where you can go and get all your information that you need. We have web-based enrollments, we have web-based document uploads, we have web-based checking of those credentials, and we have schedule, we have exams scheduled all over the world. What we obviously now continue to do is to upgrade, to update the exam. As new information comes to hand, and as we upgrade, we also gotta continuously upgrade and update the exam. For anybody who thinks that they're going to do the exam later on, let me assure you that every year the bar will rise. The easiest exam will be for the early adapters. The hardest exam will be for the late resistors. Just FYI, right? We're, and this is not something that we have discussed yet, but there is an opportunity to actually do the exam in Lithuanian. At the moment, it's scheduled to be in English, but we have found means and ways to translate the exams for not all that much money. I mean, I actually have to commend you people here because I can't see anybody with a headphones on and simultaneous translation. So I'm in awe of your people's ability to understand. Well, maybe you don't understand anything. You just nodded to me and smile at me friendly. But I suspect you actually do understand what we're talking about, right? And so obviously our view is that if you take the exam, let's say in Mandarin, it doesn't make much sense if you have to learn the study material in English, right? So clearly you have to study material in Mandarin too in order to then sit the exam in Mandarin. That kind of goes hand in glove, right? But we have now Spanish, we have Portuguese, we have Mandarin, and we have Korean. Those are the ones we've committed to for next year. We're going to start publishing retired questions. We only, as I said, had the first exam last year. So you're probably going to be the fifth exam around the world. I'll show you in a minute. We're obviously going to recruit more institutions to do what Kaunas is doing, hopefully in Saudi Arabia and in other places around the world. We obviously need to start to work on the recertification rules. And the process at the moment, your certification lasts for 10 years, which is kind of a global standard. But it doesn't make much sense if you never use something, right? We believe in the principle of use it or lose it, right? And so if you continuously practice lifestyle medicine, you should never have to resit. If you never practice, maybe you have to resit every 3 or 4 years. But we're working on this. And we obviously want to continue to provide superior exams. Just quickly, here are the exams that we had around the world. So first exam we had in Tucson, we had 221 physicians and 48 PhD and masters who passed. We had a 91% pass rate. Of the older questions, the 150 questions we asked, the highest score was 78%. The lowest score was 37%. The mean was 61%. And the board decided to set the cutoff at 51%. So anybody who had more than 51% of the questions right passed, which led to a pass rate of 91%. Now, every time we update the exam, we obviously have to run the psychometrics again. We had in Manila, I shared with you, we had 17 physicians and 2 PhD masters. And in Australia, we had 18 and 4. So what's coming up now is we have Edinburgh, in England, that's the next exam. That's organized by the British Society of Lifestyle Medicine, and then we're gonna have Brisbane, we have Seoul. But again, the key thing there is in the middle, Kaunas. So I really encourage you to get studying, get yourself certified so the world can become your oyster and you can get one of them or one of them. So thanks for listening.
Was to think about passing this exciting exam and to become lifestyle medicine professional, especially I have in mind our young participants of the Congress, on conference. And now it's my pleasure to invite on the stage Dr. John Kelly. And until he comes to the stage, I will shortly tell why John is here. John Kelly is medical director of Black Hills Health and Education Center and founding president of American College of Lifestyle Medicine. Also, faculty member of Preventive Medicine, Loma Linda University School of Medicine. Dr. Kelly was the recipient of the inaugural ACLM Trailblazer Award for his leadership in the field of lifestyle medicine and launched one of the first clinical fellowships in lifestyle medicine at the Black Hills Health and Education Center in South Dakota, where he now serves as medical director. And the topic of John today is epigenetics and lifestyle medicine. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and welcome to each one of you here. Thank you for the invitation to be again here. I was here 2 years ago, and it was a first time experience. I really enjoyed coming to your country. This time I enjoyed it as well, but I have to say we've been so busy for the last 10 days, I could hardly know which direction I was going. So I want to show a video. Oh, that's not gonna, I just realized it's not gonna work because I forgot to load it off of my thumb drive. So we'll just move on. So I wanna share something with you that's hot off the press, as they say. To lead the first intensive lifestyle medicine program in Lithuania, as Dean Ramune mentioned earlier. And we're gonna be publishing, the plan is to publish the results. But here are just some highlights real quickly. So it was a 10-day program, but really the blood tests were only 7 days. We did Monday morning to Monday morning. So in 7 days, had 7 women, 4 men. There was a diabetic who was taking insulin. And here I'm just showing you a few numbers, the total cholesterol beginning, ending, and the percent change in 1 week. And what we saw was the average was 6.46. Which is 250 milligrams per deciliter, and the ending average was 5.5, so that's a 14% drop. Now when we look at the person who had the highest, the worst cholesterol, that was a 10.4 and dropped to 7.6, that's a 2.8 millimoles per liter, a remarkable change. If it happened in a month or 6 months, you would be quite happy. This happened in 7 days. So that's a 27% reduction. The LDL, this is the most dangerous cholesterol, the low density lipoprotein, and the average was 4, and that dropped to 3.3, 18% drop. The glucose average was not so bad, 5.45. As I said, we only had one diabetic. And that drops still to 5.3, 6% drop. But when we look at the diabetic, the number was a little higher, 6.09, dropped to 5.39, so that's 11% drop in 7 days. I'm very pleased with this. And I'm sure that when these individuals get their next blood test 2 or 3 months, that if they continue what they're doing, they're gonna see continued improvement. This is a very busy slide. I won't go into it very much, but it is showing the beginning and ending cholesterol, the beginning and ending LDL, the beginning and ending glucose, and the, let me see, maybe this will help me point at it, and the beginning and ending SF36, which is a validated measure of quality of life. And we saw tremendous improvements. You can see the p-values are all highly significant changes. And let me just So it's, here, I just want to show you here. There's see the bold line is the mean, but the lighter color lines are the one for each individual. You can actually see that one or two people actually went up a little bit. Their numbers went up some. And this is, I won't go into the details, but because we tracked their changes, we understand why that happened. And then there's the LDL, the lines again showing you the kind of changes we had. And the what I'm really happy about is that there was not a single person that was above the 5.5 cut point for glucose in 1 week. And then the SF36. Okay. So that was just a little, like I say, hot off the press. Let's talk now about the science of lifestyle medicine. You know, we were just having a little meeting this morning, which, by the way, I really enjoyed that, Ramune and the colleagues that were there. I enjoyed that hour this morning. But one of the things that my wife and I, who work together in lifestyle, have come to recognize and accept, embrace, is that as the scientist, if you will, I'm not claiming to be a scientist, but I'm very focused on the scientific evidence. We often say, she and I, that my talks convince the patient to try it, and her food convinces them to keep doing it. So I'm going to talk about the science. Now, you know, the idea of choice and genetics have been like two different worlds. It's like, wait a minute, you're going to talk to me about my genetic heritage and you're going to talk about choice? I mean, I can't choose my parents. How can I choose my genetics? However, that even though that sounds very logical, that is old science. That is not true. And I want to talk about that. And you can see why I always talk about this with patients, because we need to educate the patient to realize that their DNA is not their fate. They're not trapped by their genes. So geneticists have discovered that the simple choices we make determine the effect our genes have on us. And we had no choice about our parents or the genes they gave us, but our choices today, right this moment, have everything to do with what those genes do and to us and for us. You know, Stefan, I appreciate that the last few times I've been with him, when he speaks, he asks us all to stand up, and I think that's wonderful. Do you realize that gene switches change from sitting to standing? Did you know that if you become active, if we start walking around the auditorium, that the gene switches in our muscles and other places in our body would change within minutes versus just sitting? And this has been shown by research. So this is called epigenetics. It's turning everything we know really upside down. Right now in the US, the National Institutes of Health, they now are including gene switch measures along with each study of genetics, because the fact you have a gene does not itself prove whether that gene is being expressed phenotypically or not. And so if you try to do an association study looking to see what genes are determining what phenotypic characteristics, you will not recognize an association if half of the people in your sample, the gene is turned off, and half of them is turned on. Hopefully that should be very obvious to you. And so this is why, to really sort out the human genome, we're having to study epigenetics along with just the DNA sequence. So we have choices that we hardly imagine we do. You have choices. My patients have choices that they don't realize they have. For example, imagine that you could choose which genes to turn on and which to turn off. Would you be interested in knowing how to do that? Would you actually go somewhere and read about it? Well, you don't have to, because I'm going to tell you how to do that. But the point is, you can and you do. Notice what I said. You do every day determine what genes you will turn on and which ones you will turn off. Now, you do not have control, as far as we know, of 100% of your genes. But the percent that you have control of continues to grow in the scientific understanding. Genes we did not think we had control of, we're finding out we do have control of. And this is a pretty exciting thing to me, anyway. Suppose we could silence genes or express genes for specific characteristics by the simple choice of what we eat. To me, that would be good news. I like to eat. I usually do it 2 or 3 times a day, sometimes 4 times. But the point is, that means that every time that I eat, I can put into action my choice of how I want my genes to be on or off. In fact, even if I don't make the choice, my actions drive gene expression. So just a little background about me and some of the project I've worked on, by the way. So I did a $2 million research project with Brenda Davis in the Marshall Islands. That's actually how Brenda and I first worked together. And in the Marshall Islands, they have about a 40% prevalence of type 2 diabetes. It's hard to comprehend how. So they're probably 20 years, 30 years ahead of the European countries. Fortunately, in America, we don't have probably more than 12 to 16%. They do say we have an unrecognized number of diabetics that don't know they're diabetic. But in the Marshall Islands, it's about 40%, and it's actually breaking the Ministry of Health. The Ministry of Health is the one that wanted us to do this study to see if lifestyle could reduce the epidemic and hopefully reverse diabetes. Frankly, like many people, they were hopeful but skeptical. They did not believe that what we were going to do would work. But they were, I have to give them credit, they let us give it a try. So anyway, I don't know if you can, that's Brenda right here in the picture. We call that, by the way, this frame here is our compounding pharmacy. You know, in lifestyle medicine, we have a lot of the same aspects that we do in regular, non-lifestyle medicine. And that is we have a pharmacy, and it's spelled with an F, F-A-R-A-C-Y. Anyway, pharmacy. Anyway, and then here's this exercise area was for evaluating fitness. Not really. We did not train them that they had to be on a machine to get exercise. You do not want to make lifestyle habits difficult for your patients. You want to make them as simple and easy as possible to do. So we taught them to walk. That's something most people actually already know how to do. So this was the results from our first 10 days. This is the morning finger sticks before and after exercise. But this regression line shows you that we had in 10 days, we had a 74 milligram per deciliter drop. I'm sorry, I cannot translate that immediately, but I believe it's somewhere in the neighborhood of just under 2 millimoles, maybe 1.5. So it was a dramatic improvement. And in fact, when I've shown this slide around the world to different medical conferences, I often have a diabetologist say to me, "So what did you do? Did you put an insulin pump? You know, what kind of technology did you bring to the Marshall Islands?" And we said, no, the two people that were on insulin, we had to stop the insulin. So in lifestyle medicine, if it's intensive enough, you do not have to worry about insulin dosing. If it's type 2 diabetes, you just stop it. So then this is another case. I'm showing you two of what I call my cases, and then I'm going to, before I show you the point. So CK, this is CK here, in the sort of facing our direction. I don't know if you can recognize that. That's me with my clinical coat on. And CK had heart disease. And he had been diagnosed by a very competent internist who had noticed, even though CK was quite fit and his METs on his treadmill was quite high, at the high end, there was some abnormality on the EKG. So she sent him to get an echocardiogram. Here's a simulation. This is where we can visualize the heart. And the result was that the cardiologist explained what needed to be done. that after he had reviewed everything, the cardiologist recommended that CK undergo coronary angiography with intervention, which in plain lingo is a stent. Now, CK did not want to have this procedure because, like many of our modern patients, he was internet savvy, and he found out that about 1 in 500 could be very dangerous, and you might have an accident, you might have to go and have open heart surgery. And he thought he ought to try, and after all, he didn't feel that sick. He wanted to try lifestyle. So he made some lifestyle changes himself. And lo and behold, Stefan, he became a vegetarian, okay? I mean, that's really radical. But his cholesterol still did not come down enough to reverse this condition, and so he contacted me. And I said, well, you can come to our center. So he came, spent a couple of months. We had an outpatient center in Virginia. It's in the East Coast of the United States. And we were using the CHIP program that's been mentioned earlier because it was the most evidence-based program that we could find at the time. So he went through our program and exercised vigorously every day. And he went to a cardiologist in our area, Dr. Austin. And this cardiologist said the echo portion of the test was considered negative for ischemia. The patient has done well with lifestyle changes. The plan is he would continue with diet and exercise and aspirin. So every time, so he had no stent, right? And every time I show these kind of examples, I always get some in the audience who say, yes, but Dr. Kelly, I've got bad genes. It's in my genes. You know, my parents have it, grandparents have it. I want to ask you a question. Do you know that you do not only inherit genes from your parents? You inherit recipes. You inherit lifestyle habits. I certainly did. And so, the fact is, there's a big question about how much does my genes have limit my ability to have health. Time magazine had a complete issue on this. The whole issue is dedicated to why your DNA isn't your destiny. Here's a little historical photo. This is Watson and Crick there receiving the Nobel Prize for their discovery of deoxyribonucleic acid. That molecule there on the right-hand side was the molecule of inheritance. This is a picture of Dr. Francis Collins, who's now director of the National Institutes of Health in the U.S., but he was the head of the Human Genome Project. And did you know we have 3 billion base pairs of human DNA, 3 billion of these things? By the way, that's in every nucleus. That's not in your total body. So you've got 3 billion times perhaps 3 trillion of these base pairs. Millions of variations. I'm going to move forward quickly this morning. In the handout, you'll have access to all of the slides. So I want to just call your attention to simple biology here for a moment. Where do we come from? So here, where do these little hedgehogs come from? We come from a single cell called an ovum, in the case of mammals, or an egg, if you will. That meets up with and is combined with a sperm cell. And those two cells become a single cell that has a complete set of chromosomes. And then that cell either becomes two cells or it can die if it doesn't find a nice home in the uterus, it will die. But if it does find a nest, it becomes two cells. Each of those become two cells until, in the case of humans, 9 months later, we're born with trillions of cells. So here's my question for you. If every cell in your body has a copy of the same DNA, then tell me, how is it that it makes such different tissues? Some nose, some toes, or quills. Do you realize you have all the genes for a liver in your ear? And aren't you glad they're turned off? So the fact is that the switches on the genes are becoming to be realized they're perhaps more important to our phenotype than the gene itself. It's like we have lights in the room here, and thank you for the lights. But without switches, the lights would be not very pleasant. It's nice to be able to turn them on and off when we want to, isn't it? As Dr. Whitelaw, who's a recognized expert in this field, says, so I'll quote her, we don't actually inherit DNA from our parents. What we inherit are chromosomes. And the chromosomes are actually only half, 50% DNA, and the other 50% is protein molecules, and it turns out that the protein molecules carry heritable information, not just the DNA. So, there's a little graphic of it, methyl groups and epigenetic factors. These are some of the known switching mechanisms. I'm not going to go into that much, but the bottom line is that the genes are turned on and off by environmental influences. And the whole science of nutrigenomics is based on that premise. And when you were born with genes that had switches, and the switches were on or off. So we started life with our gene switch positioned by the environmental influences from our ancestors, which is very interesting. My wife always loves this part. Hopefully you'll enjoy it again this morning, dear. But she says, don't forget to tell them this little fact again about human development. We know, and we've known for a long time, that the ova that develop in the female ovary, the eggs, form in the first 3 or 4 months of development while the embryo or the fetus is growing. So that means that the egg that I came from was formed in my mother's ovary when she was in my grandmother's womb. So it's not so surprising that there is transgenerational effects, and they're in Sweden, where they have remarkable records for a number of years, they've been able to actually identify that things that happened to the nutritional status of the grandmother and the grandfather have measurable impact on chronic disease in the grandchildren. So a little illustration. So here's the gene, is the light hair going on and off, the epigenetic switch. But it's a little more complicated than that. We're discovering now that some of the genes have literally hundreds or thousands of switches. And it's much more complicated than the DNA itself. So I want to tell you about two studies. I need a timekeeper. Somebody, I need to know when I have 5 minutes, unless I'm already over, then don't tell me. No, I'm just kidding. So I want to tell you about two studies, and I don't want to go over the time this morning, and I did not bring my timepiece with me. I left it with my dear wife, so you'll have to be the timekeeper. So anyway, one of these mice on the screen is, you might catch it in a trap in your kitchen or pantry and throw it away. The other one, if you catch it, you hope that you didn't kill it, and you definitely don't throw it away, because it is worth hundreds of thousands of dollars. And it's the cute blonde. This is an agouti mouse. The agouti mouse has been so valuable because it took a lot of work to engineer the DNA on this mouse so that it has the characteristics for obesity, heart disease, diabetes, all kinds of human disease, so that it can be studied in a mouse model, and that it's these genes are transmitted from generation to generation. This was not a simple thing to do. And researchers who were working on epigenetics had come to the conclusion that it appeared that you should be able to alter gene switches in utero. They were looking for a model to study this idea, and they hit upon the agouti mouse. So the researchers thought, you know, if we could get an agouti mouse pregnant, and while she's pregnant, developing babies, we could feed her the right way, maybe we could change those genes that were programmed into her, okay? And sure enough, this was published first in the Experimental Biology in 1998. And it's still making waves in the world as people learn about it. But this is a picture of the mother and the baby. Now, you know, if this was a human situation, we would have a paternity suit, because that is definitely not my baby. But the fact is, even though the phenotype is dramatically different, you can just look and see. When you do a DNA study, those two mice have the same genes for obesity, heart disease, etc. But the expression is completely different, which is another illustration of why, if you want to study the relationship between genes and phenotype, you have to study epigenetics. So, sure enough, that these mice both have genes, but one was turned off. In fact, here's some from the actual article itself. They said they could see that this environmental phenotype, in other words, the healthy attributes, were inherited for up to 3 to 4 generations. They used a DNA methylating diet. Yes, folks, the difference between these two mice and the gene expression was diet during pregnancy. I stop to emphasize that because I see a lot of young women in the audience, as well as young men. Listen, you're not eating before and during pregnancy just for yourself. You're giving your child a good heritage, a good legacy. So anyway, pretty exciting. Now rats. So the last one we were talking about, a mouse that was very valuable, and they were using diet to turn off genes. Now I want to show you a study, the Journal of Neuroscience 2008, where they were looking at an ordinary laboratory rat, and they were studying, could you turn on genes? Because the mouse showed you could turn them off. How about turning them on? And sure enough, they found that by feeding a high-fat diet to a pregnant rat with some elegant research, most of it which I understand was done in Canada, was done showing that the high-fat diet caused overexpression of a gene on chromosome 3 in the developing brain of the baby. And this increased expression caused an increased proliferation of neurons, neurogenesis. You know, we could stop just a second right there. In fact, let me see. I think I know how to do this. So you can get your attention off the picture a moment. What did I just say? I just said to you that by the way they fed the mother during pregnancy changed the brain anatomy of the baby. The way they fed the mother during pregnancy changed the brain anatomy of the baby. It's a wake-up call. So then those neurons just happen to be the type of neurons that actually form the hypothalamus. They migrated to the hypothalamus during the embryonic development. And then when the baby was born in adolescence, they looked at the phenotype traits. And this baby, this rat, had higher blood lipids. Their cholesterol and triglycerides were too high. Their food intake was higher. They preferred larger hamburgers instead of small ones. They preferred fat. That was a joke. They did. So they preferred fat if they had a choice. They had an early puberty onset, and their body weight was greater. Now, this happened in November of 2008, and if you check your history, you'll see that the American Heart Association was having a meeting at that time. And the health reporter from the Wall Street Journal asked the director of the American Heart Association to comment on this study, which had just come out. And she said, "This study shows there's a lot more to America's obesity epidemic than we have ever realized." Because if you know they fed a high-fat diet to the mother and it resulted in what kind of a preference in the child? A high-fat diet. So this is a self-perpetuating feedback loop. Now the good news is that you can change your behavior. You can change the gene switches. But what we're saying is this was the influence of the developing mother's diet. So this A specific phenotype was induced using a high-fat diet here. This is Dr. Andrew Feinberg. He's one of the world-recognized experts in epigenetics, so I'll let him speak. I'm quoting him here. "Epigenetics is at the epicenter of modern medicine," he says. But you know, it's not only that. Oops. It's that lifestyle medicine is at the epicenter of epigenetics because the research so far reveals that the one thing that has the greatest impact on the gene switches is actually our diet and our exercise, our sleep, etc. So we can do more to change our gene switches by the choices we make each day in how we eat, how we move, etc. It's been brought out. One last one is in men. This is a gene expression study in 30 men with prostate cancer, and these men had low risk, slow growing cancer. They did not receive surgery or radiation treatment. Instead, they got into this study and they had a comprehensive lifestyle change program, very much like what we did at UPA, only theirs was for 90 days, 3 months. They had serial biopsies, so the researchers actually took a little sample of tissue from the prostate cancer, and from that they were able to purify the messenger RNA. So from the messenger RNA they could determine what genes were being expressed. And this is the bottom line of this study. This is what's called a heat map. There's 30 columns on each side. So there's 30 columns over here, one for each man, and there's 30 over here on the right, one for each man. And each row is a different messenger RNA that they were able to identify. The color of each one of these squares or cells then is dark if there's a lot of messenger RNA, or light if there wasn't much. So you can look and see that there's much darker on the left than on the right. In fact, what the researchers found was that over 450 genes were changed in these cancer cells, turned down or off, about 50 turned on or up as a result of the lifestyle change program that they had. And I'm going to hasten on, and like I say, the handouts, you can see more of it. But I want to show you something. This is so important about lifestyle medicine. One of the things that's frustrating to us as physicians when we're using conventional medicine is when we give a person a certain pharmaceutical remedy, we have to be sure that it's within the therapeutic window and that it doesn't cause any ill effects. So there's certain medicines that if I put a patient on as a responsible physician, I have to monitor their liver enzymes or I have to monitor their kidney function. But in lifestyle medicine, it's really nice. I feel very relieved because I don't have that problem. What I see is, this was, by the way, what were we treating? We were treating cancer. But these men lost weight. They had a healthy change in weight. Their blood pressure came down. Total cholesterol dropped. My goodness, that's a pretty remarkable improvement. And so in lifestyle medicine, what happens is you treat one disease, but you improve a large array of disease at the same time. So I'm going to just summarize this one here. Sleep deprivation, Surrey University, they looked at the effect of sleep deprivation on gene expression, and they found that about 700 genes were changed as a result of simply depriving them of sleep. And we don't fully understand what all those genes are doing, but some of them have to do with important functions. So this is Dr. Jertl. This is the gentleman that did the study in the agouti mouse. This was a younger picture there. He looks a little more distinguished now. You know, like me, gray hair. Nonetheless, here's what he had to say. Epigenetics is proving we have some responsibility for the integrity of our genome. Think about his choice of words here. Before epigenetics, genes predetermined outcomes. That's what we thought. That's what we were taught. Now, everything we do, everything we eat or smoke, can affect our gene expression and that of future generations. So epigenetics introduces the concept of what? Free will into our idea of genetics, and that is why our patients need to understand this so they do not blame their choices, the effect of their choices, on their genes. I want to just summarize here. It's changing your diet and lifestyle. We've shown how that changes your epigenome, or the protein switches. If you change the switches, that they change gene expression. And if you change gene expression, you literally change the organism. Another talk some other time, but we are human beings, scientists, are successfully turning skin cells into functioning cardiac cells. Doing it in mice right now. But we are now, we've learned that aging is not inevitable. It's actually imposed upon the body by changes in the epigenetic switches. And they are able to reverse the age of individual cells so far by changing the switches on the genes. Aging is a product of deterioration of gene expression, not time. I'm going to skip a couple of these here. Because I want to end with this closing thought. Well, this may be some of the most important thing I'm going to share with you in the next three or four slides. And that is, we know, all of us in medicine, even all of us who are patients know, that treatment effects are different for different dosing. If you take a medication that the doctor prescribes at 100 milligrams and you take 1 milligram, you have no rational basis to go to the doctor and say, the medicine's not working. It's like, well, wait a minute, why don't you take 100 milligrams and see how that works? Well, we're doing that with lifestyle medicine. Because in lifestyle medicine, we are often prescribing what would be an effective preventive dose and then saying, well, it's not reversing disease. You have to have a sufficient dose to reverse. You can take a smaller dose to prevent. So a treatment, notice this line here, a treatment dosing window in pharmaceuticals is determined by a minimum effective dose and a maximum safe dose. And any responsible clinician will try to maintain somewhere between that, right? The bottom, the upper and lower dose. Well, this turns out to exist for practically everything, including lifestyle medicine, diet, exercise, etc. So I'm not going to read this, but I wanted you to see this. This is important. The Look Ahead Diabetes Trial was a multi-million dollar study in the United States, a four-year randomized trial. They were looking to see how, in what they called intensive lifestyle change, compared to the standard diabetes support and education. And what the result of the study was, right here, they found that the diabetes support and education, which is the dark color, they only had about 2% of the patients that had any remission, had any significant improvement at these years, you can see. So at 4 years, it's just around 2%. But with the more intensive intervention, they had a much higher prevalence of remission. Okay, but now we're looking, just real quickly, you should look these up. The direct diabetes trial, which is now in process in England, is a much more intensive intervention, okay? And what they found, I want to show you. So this is the same trial that I just, the same data we just looked at, okay? The intensive intervention in yellow. But look what happened. The direct trial in their first year had a 46% of partial or complete remission of type 2 diabetes. That's news. That's important. That's a proof in concept. This is just with lifestyle change. That in general practice clinics in Northern Europe and Southern Scotland, I think, is where they'd recruited these 50 practices. So these are ordinary people going to ordinary doctors, giving them a very low calorie diet intervention, and 46% of them had partial or complete remission. This, my friends, and this is brand new. I don't know if you see the dates on this. Well, not the, let me see here. This one, February of this year. And so what I wanted to show you here. So this is what they found in the direct trial, was that the remission is directly related to weight loss, okay? But now to put it in scope, look when I put the look ahead data on there. So what this shows is that our diabetes support and education is way too weak. It's namby-pamby. It's not making any significant difference. The intensive lifestyle intervention that they compared it to in the look ahead trial was better, but it's not there. The dosing is not strong enough. We need to reverse disease. Don't be afraid of cranking up the voltage. Anyway, I'm sure my time's up. Thank you for your time and attention. And I applaud you, what you're doing at Kaunas University and what you're doing in Lithuania.
Thank you, John, for such an amazing evidence. And in fact, so I think it was very interesting what we have heard. And now I will welcome our dear friend, Professor Adrian Kennedy, to come on stage. And until Adrian is coming, I will shortly introduce him, because Adrian is the founder and managing director of Lifetime Wellness International Limited, in Apollo Hospital Group Initiative, also the president of the Health and Wellness Association in India, intensively developing this topic in the United Arab Emirates. With his academic background in business, law, and health from USA, he has over 35 years of working experience in the area of health and wellness. And he holds a patent and copyright for the computerized health scan, for which he received the World Health Award 2000. So in addition, as director of Apollo Hospital Educational Research Foundation, he has created postgraduate academic programs in lifestyle medicine, integrated medicine, and wellness management, and is the faculty for the Harvard Medical School in this subject. Adrian.
Thank you so much for that introduction. Dr. Rumone is a dear friend. About 40 years back, I did my PhD dissertation in the use of lifestyle change for the improvement of health in corporate organizations. The use of lifestyle change to improve the health of corporate organizations was my PhD 40 years ago. And I've had the supreme privilege of implementing lifestyle change in corporate organizations across several countries over the last three or four decades. A few years back, perhaps a year back, Thomas, the coordinator of our program, visited me in the UAE to understand what it is we did in the area of lifestyle change to see whether it would be relevant to the students of the Lithuanian University of Health Sciences. And not more than a week or 10 days back, I had the supreme joy of being with Dr. Rumone when she visited the UAE to understand what it is that we do in the area of lifestyle medicine. I'm going to offer to our students the possibility of making lifestyle change or making their studies relevant in organizations around the world to improve health. What are the objectives of corporate wellness? Corporate wellness does not only require that you improve the health of a population. Now, that is an excellent objective. That is a kind social objective. And that objective is the basis of the outlook of the European community. The European community felt that by improving the health of the human being, it will be socially justifiable to implement corporate wellness. The Americans had a slightly different perspective. They felt that in order to justify the utilization of resources for the improvement of health within an organization, there had to be a financial return. And therefore, corporate health embraces these two broad objectives. One objective is that the work you do must ensure that the overall population improves in health. The second objective is that by improving the health of the community, you must ensure an improvement in human productivity, a reduction in Medicare costs, and therefore an improvement in profits, which meets the prime objective of the existence of a corporate organization. I was asked in my presentation to present the work that we have done over the last 3 years. And therefore, I'm confining my presentation only to the last 3 or 4 years. And in the last 3 or 4 years, the average utilization was 20,000 lives. And what we achieved in the overall health implementation, you could see. By implementing lifestyle change, we were able to improve, to reduce the health of the population. We were able to improve the health of the population. We were able to increase exercise activity. We were able to reduce stress and tension. But you don't always succeed within a limited space of time. You will notice, of course, that our failure was in the fact that there was an increase in the number of smokers. Now, when we went into the evaluation as to why this happened, we discovered that there was, in fact, a 30% turnover of the employed workforce, which means that you were not always dealing with the same population for review for year on year. But this only meets one of the objectives, and that is the utilization of lifestyle for the improvement of health in a population. What about the medical aspect? How does this translate? How does this translate into the improvement of chronic disease? You will notice that in these slides, we had an improvement in hypertension. It reduced. We were able to reduce overall cardiac risk. We were able to improve productivity, and we were also able to improve the overall health of these organizations. So how does one achieve results such as this? How does one improve the health of an organization and improve the productivity of an organization? There has to be some methodology. The systems we use are very simple. We make available the health screening, and this health screening helps us to define the baseline. You know exactly what the status is of an organization in the beginning of the year, and you will reevaluate the health of the organization at the end of the year to see the difference. And in between the year, you will make available a whole range of activities. So step one would be the improvement, would be the evaluation of the organization. When you do the health screening, you not only make available the biomed data, such as blood pressure and diabetes, but we tag on the change, which is lifestyle. If lifestyle is the cause of disease, then lifestyle can also reverse disease. And therefore, we counsel each individual. We believe that in order to improve the health of an organization, it's best to transfer the responsibility from the physician to the client. And the only way you can do that, or the best way in which you can achieve this, is by education. And therefore, we make available health education to the population to teach them the relevance, or to show them the relevance of lifestyle change in their lives. And then, of course, lifestyle is a daily activity, and therefore we make available health activities through the year. The bottom line is that we make available systems that keep the employee engaged through the year. Who implements these systems? If you are talking in terms of lifestyle evaluation, if you are talking in terms of a health screening, if you are talking in terms of health counseling, if you are talking in terms of health education, if you are talking in terms of implementing various lifestyle activities, lifestyle change activities within an organization, then how do you do this? You do this by making available an accredited lifestyle team. The lifestyle team would usually comprise of a physician who normally manages the screening and other aspects. You have the nurse to support. You have the psychologist. You have the nutritionist. You have the physical therapist. Now this team of four or five individuals, with most of their work being automated, would be able to manage 10,000 lives. So one team comprising of five individuals usually has an output of about 10,000 lives. The ratio is one team to approximately 550 to 100 clients a day. And they divide their responsibilities between them. So you have the system, you have the team, and now you have the engagement. How do you keep an organization occupied with improving health throughout the year? You start with the screening, and the screening at the rate of 50 or 100 clients a day, a biometric lifestyle screening, would take about a half hour per client. You would finish about 50 odd clients in a day, and therefore 1,000 clients may take a few months. Now, in case you have more organizations, you would obviously have more teams, or you would have teams within an organization. So we would start with the lifestyle screening, and then the lifestyle screening, which is automated and created by us over years of utilization, makes available the specific needs of an individual. So we put this individual into various categories of group counseling or group education. So the first aspect is that you would do the screening. The second aspect is you would make available specific education. The third aspect is you would then make available different types of activities. These activities could be a walkathon challenge, it could be a weight loss challenge, it could be a quit smoking group, different types of activities that are relevant specifically to the individual. And you mesh this all together by sending specific weekly tips. Now, this is a sample of one organization. We manage 20 to 30 organizations. And therefore, you would use one team to cover about 10,000 lives. And if your numbers increase, you would obviously have more teams to manage this. So what exactly is your health screening? Your health screening covers several aspects. First of all, you have the medical aspects, the numbers, the blood pressure, the blood sugar, the BMI, and other such aspects. Now, we know that all these chronic disease-related factors, hypertension, diabetes, hypercholesterolemia, etc., are all lifestyle-related. So therefore, you need to correlate the medical numbers with the lifestyle evaluation. So you do the biomed screening, and simultaneously, you have the connectivity of lifestyle evaluation. So you're able to evaluate the cause with the effect. Once you do that, the client moves into counseling. In case the client has problems related to diabetes or hypertension or high cardiac risk, he would go into a disease management counseling session or disease management programs through the year. Otherwise, he would be specifically counseled in lifestyle change related to several of these aspects. In case he's overweight, he would be counseled on weight. In case he's physically unfit, he would be advised on the benefits of exercise. In case he needs to quit smoking, that advice would be given. In case the individual needs to manage stress, that advice would be given. And therefore, the client would know on day one exactly what his problem is and what the probable solutions are. So the first aspect would be evaluation of health and counseling. You've completed the evaluation of an organization that has maybe 1,000 or more or less employees. You compile all this information and data together, and you get what is known as a group health profile or a group health audit. This group health audit enables you to identify the status of that organization. And then you compare it with year two after implementing all your systems. You would then know where the improvement has been or where the emphasis needs to be. So this tells you the precise method by which the organization needs to move forward, or you need to move the organization forward in order to improve health. So in step one, you would do the health evaluation of the individual. You would compile all that information together, and you would create a group profile. This group profile is what tells the organization, or tells you how to move forward and where the pitfalls or where the high risk areas in that organization is. You're not only able to measure the health requirements of the organization, you're also able to measure the improvement of Medicare costs, the improvement of productivity, and other such factors related to cost. So you have the individual profile, you have the group profile. Then you have these specifically directed health education programs. So the prescription in the corporate organization would identify that 80% of your population is overweight, 60% of your population is highly stressed, 25 or 30% of your population are smokers, and so on and so forth, and they would benefit from education in these areas. You have a multidisciplinary team. If you have a high risk, or you would definitely have 20 to 30% of individuals with hypertension, diabetes, and other such factors, your physician would take care of these health education programs. So these programs would talk about disease management. Your psychologist would take care of the stress management programs or the happiness programs and other such mental well-being programs. Your nutritionist would manage the nutrition-related programs. Your exercise therapist would talk in terms of the fitness programs. Now, all of these individuals are certified lifestyle professionals. I will come to that point a little later. But you still have a team of five individuals, just five, who are managing 10,000 lives by doing multi-activities. And all of them are lifestyle professionals. And then you would have activities through the year. These activities could be of different types, but my background is a background in sport, and therefore I make it a point, in whichever country or city I am in, I create what is known as an inter-corporate sports challenge, which means that corporate organizations participate in age-related sports activities through the year. It could be basketball, or it could be handball, or it could be any of the games that have a team composition. Now, this team composition not only improves the health of the individual, but it also improves mental well-being. It teaches you how to share. It teaches you how to take defeat. It teaches you how to work for success, and so many other factors that are relevant to business management. But in addition to that, of course, you create little societies, the quit smoking group, which is managed internally by the organization. You have the stress management group and the relaxation and sleep group that works on improvement of sleep. And you have the weight loss group, or the step-a-thon challenge, or the walk-a-thon challenge, or even the five-minute exercise program. Now, I recall Stephen, I think it was, who, as soon as we started our program, got us all to stand up. I mean, he was absolutely right. Sitting is the new smoking. And therefore, we make it a point to try and emphasize and inculcate in all our organizations a five-minute exercise program at the beginning or at the end of work. Just a five-minute exercise program. Now, that program would be very simple, and I'll show it to you within a minute. Please watch. You would start with the leg rotation, and then the shoulder rotation, and then the elbows, and then the wrist, and then the fingers. Then you have the waist, and then you move to the lower body. You could walk, cardiorespiratory stand up, you could run, and then you could do deep breathing. Now, this five-minute exercise program, that must have taken not more than a minute, but you multiply that into 10 repetitions, and you have approximately 4 or 5 minutes. Now, even while a program like this may not improve your health, it will definitely restrict your health from deteriorating further. And more important, it will, any activity that is repeated on a day-to-day basis becomes a habit. You get hooked onto exercise, and this is a good thing. It helps you to improve so many other aspects. Our customers are delighted. At the end of every year, at the end of every program, you need to evaluate how your customers feel about you. Now remember, I'm making this presentation with the objective that our young students who are graduating can look at corporate wellness as a career option. Now understand this. There are hundreds of thousands of corporate organizations around the world. There are hundreds of thousands of insurance companies around the world. And all these organizations, more and more, are beginning to utilize lifestyle change professionals and health professionals to manage the health of a population or an organization. And the reason for this is because of escalating Medicare costs. The only way you can prevent escalating Medicare costs and improve productivity and improve profits is by improving the health of the human being. And therefore, this offers great opportunities to our young graduates. I, for myself, have been in this field for more than 40 years. So you get a review and feedback of the organization, of the various organizations. And taking these organizations, I'll tell you what we did to get this feedback. Here is the largest ceramic manufacturing company in the world. Happens to be in our city, the Rack Ceramics. It has about 2,000 to 3,000 employees in a single factory, and it has several factories. If you were to take the health analysis of this organization over 2 years, over 3 years is what we've shown, you will find that the fitness levels of the employees have improved. Weight has reduced, stress has reduced, the overall cardiac risk factors have improved. If you look at it from a financial perspective, remember, organizations are a business. They would like their employees to be healthy if it meets with the motive of profit. That is so important to them. And therefore, if you look at the financial objectives, absenteeism reduces. Presenteeism improves. Now, it has been explained in earlier talks that presenteeism is physical presence with mental absence. And this mental absence can come from so many factors, relating to problems at home, relating to stress and tension, financial issues, and so many, many other issues. So, by implementing a corporate health program, you're able to improve presenteeism, absenteeism, human productivity. A healthy individual will give you far better returns than an individual who is health impaired. So individuals who do lifestyle change and exercise and weight loss, etc., are far more physically productive per shift. And therefore, that there is a return. And then you have the evaluation of overall score. Now remember, whatever you do is being evaluated online, real time. So you have no means of adjusting any outcomes. Because these outcomes are the outcomes that appear in the organization's computer systems and appear in our computer systems also. So this is Rack Ceramics, which is the largest ceramic manufacturer in the world. A completely different organization, Stephen Rock, mining industry. We have about 3,000 individuals in this particular mine, You improve their fitness levels, you improved reduced weight, stress seems to have gone up over here, reduced or managed dependencies, reduced cardiac risk, from the financial aspect, the return on investment. Health is a return on value or the improvement of health, but the other aspect of the return on investment, you've reduced Medicare costs of chronic diseases. You've reduced Medicare costs, you've improved occupation, you've improved occupational risk, you've improved productivity. Facilities is the evaluation, of what the company is doing to help the employees to remain healthy. You're now talking in terms of the making available of a walking pathway. You're talking in terms of making available healthy foods in your canteens. You're talking in terms of making available employee assistance and psychological support programs and so on and so forth. Now, obviously, something like this cannot be achieved without appropriate technical validation and support. I'll take just one more minute, Dr. Amune. Cannot be achieved without such technical support. So my organization is a part of the hospital. So that hospital has 500 physicians and nurses who become a strong support system of all our programs. So you have the hospitals. Then you have the insurance companies. I no more require to go to an organization for business. The insurance companies who manage the health of organizations, each of whom has 100 or 200 corporates, come to us to tell us that we need you to help us to manage the health of the organization because we have no means of improving health. As a consequence, if an organization doesn't particularly try to improve health, the premiums and the costs go up every year. So we no more need to step out to get business. It comes to us automatically from the insurance company. All our research is done by the RAC, the medical college, which is within our organization. And of course, we are connected to the European Lifestyle Medicine Organization for validation. So in summary, what does corporate wellness mean? It means making available to an organization two things: health benefits, the wellness benefits and the medical benefits. You need to manage, you need to improve wellness, you need to manage the medical component. You also have to improve, you also have to make sure that you give the organization return on investments. And return on investments can come by making available, by getting organizations to add health facilities to their systems. Improvement of canteens, making available gym facilities, making available education to organizations. And also directly improve the finances by reducing Medicare costs, by reducing medical premiums, by improving productivity, and so on and so forth. It's embarrassing to put up a slide that indicates awards, but sometimes it becomes necessary to present that only to prove the acceptance of your systems by the larger community. So within the last few years, this little star thing over here is the award that we got for being the best corporate health company in the United Arab Republic. Thank you. Thank you. Very kind. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You don't need to clap anymore. That would embarrass me. But thank you so much for that first clap. I assume that the second and third would also have been there if I hadn't requested that it shouldn't be there. Ignore the old man holding the award. Just ignore that old man there. But that award represents the best corporate wellness organization in GCC and Africa. Now, many of these awards come to you without your even attempting to get these awards. They come to you simply because some organization somewhere is doing the research. And some world body, in this instance, the World Health Organization and other such bodies, make available these awards to organizations that achieve certain standards. The final award over there is for the best wellness company to be put within the top 50 wellness companies in the world. But the reason for my presenting these slides and making this presentation, what is the relevance of what I have to say to the young students in Lithuania? The relevance is that each individual who works in a wellness team is a certified lifestyle medicine professional. So what I'm suggesting here is that the scope is wide open. As I was mentioning in a meeting this morning, just last month, the government of Saudi Arabia took a decision to make corporate health mandatory in the kingdom. Now, what does that mean? It meant, as they informed me, to improve the health of their government employees. So I said, what are the numbers? And they said 11 million employees. And also to improve the health of private industry. When I asked the numbers, they said 9 million employees. So what are we talking about? We are talking about a single country that wants to improve the health of 20 million workers. And what is the rider? The rider is that these changes can only be implemented if the individual has a certified lifestyle change certification. And that is the great value of our program. Thank you.
Thank you, Adrian. And I'm sure that there are many questions how you are succeeding so well. And now we will have a chance of around 25 minutes. I will be the speakers of this session. So Adrian, please come back on the stage, and John and Stefan. And it's a pity that the commissioner and minister had to leave, but I'm sure that we will have a really fruitful and interesting discussion. And just for initiating the discussion, I would like to raise a few questions for our panelists. How do you see the progress of lifestyle medicine in the world and Lithuania? What do you see, what are the major challenges in this process? And what could be done to make this process more successful?
John, you're on.
So let me, I only had to answer one question, right? So I would say that what has happened since thinking of the perspective from we started the American College of Lifestyle Medicine in 2004, and so looking at we've got 14 years, I'm very candid. I'm not a plastic. So actually, I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed because I had thought we would be there already, and. But I'm very excited with the progress. So really, I feel very positive and affirmative about it. But, you know, all of us would like things to happen faster. And so I was thinking that we would already have a specialty in lifestyle medicine, a residency program, and we would have doctors who had taken their residency in lifestyle medicine. That hasn't happened yet. But I do believe it's going to happen, and we're getting much closer. So my outlook on lifestyle medicine is globally and even here locally is that it's really making tremendous strides. It is popular. That's good and bad, because the bad part is that people want to get on the bandwagon and they're calling, they're doing something and calling it lifestyle medicine. But as I tried to share in my comments about dosing, the biggest enemy of the best is often the good. Because we settle, we do something that is good, but it's not good enough, and so it ends up, we would not want lifestyle medicine, for example, to be undervalued. And so if we do not dose the treatment strong enough for the specific need of each individual patient, we may end up with the house of medicine rightly coming to the conclusion that it won't work. You know, it's not a, it looks to me like we have a room full of friends, you know, we're all drinking the same tea or Kool-Aid, as they say some places. But anyway, we all are friendly to lifestyle medicine. But if you're really honest, we have to admit that the evidence is not all in yet. And it may turn out that, the evidence will be more difficult to get to prove that lifestyle medicine can work. I'm not afraid of that challenge, but I do recognize it. The success of lifestyle medicine is not about hype and excitement, although I find it very exciting, but that's not where the success is going to come from. It's going to come from doing the hard work and making it succeed. I'll finish and let someone else talk with it. Let me make one comment to you. Do you know how long the first patient that had a heart transplant lived? The first patient that had a heart transplant. They lived a few hours to a few days. I don't know the exact number, and since I'm asking the question, I should look it up. But my point, it doesn't matter if it was hours or days. They lived less than a month. So what did we do? We said, well, this doesn't work, and we that's the end of that. We can't do it. It doesn't work. No, I mean, we do thousands. Too many, obviously, because we don't have a lifestyle medicine, but we do thousands of them. And people live to a ripe old age with somebody else's heart in their chest because the people who did this took the challenge to find a way to make it successful. And that's the challenge that if I could look at each one of the youngest ones in this room, that's your challenge. We have proven concept that this can be done, but we don't yet know how to make it succeed 90% of the time or even 70% of the time. You know, I have to say that when I do a lifestyle intervention like I did in the Marshall Islands or here in UPA, if I get a 50% success rate, I feel pretty good about it. And that, by the way, I don't feel too bad because of the REC study, they had 46%, and I can always beat 46%. But anyway, the point is, we got a lot of room for science-driven people to do some work and figure out how to make this even more effective. We want the heart transplant patient to live to a ripe old age.
I don't mean to bore you, but I want to quickly completely change the subject and actually talk about you personally. So when you look at, and again, I go back to the sickest country in the world, the United States, where healthcare is completely broken. When you look at, there is lots of people who do diabetes counseling, right? The diabetes counselors, in 50% of the case or more, are diabetics themselves. It's a bit like going to the smoking cessation program and your teacher is standing at the front, just having a quick cigarette before he teaches you how to stop smoking. When you look at the health profession in the United States, they're part of the sickest part of the population. There is more morbid obesity in orderlies and in nurses and in physicians than there within the patients. When you look at the food offered in hospitals in the United States, I would get very sick on that food that they offer in health institutions. So as a country that has gone through so many challenges like Lithuania has politically and in every other way, you people, when I look into the room, I see a lot of young people who are fit and healthy
And I strongly encourage you to maintain that, because you are the biggest advertisement for what you have for sale yourselves. If you are fit and healthy, people want to know from you how to do that. If you're not fit and healthy and you get fit and healthy, you have a wonderful story to tell. And it's a very compelling story. So I just want to encourage you. You're small enough to be nimble, to be flexible. Big countries like Germany, I talk to the people in Germany. They think they know everything, right? Sorry, Hans, but you understand what I mean, right? I mean, we've been doing this for thousands of years, and who are you to tell us how to suck eggs, right? Here, there is an ability to be nimble and to be flexible. And so I just encourage you, embrace it, go on the journey, and do it yourselves.
The journey at this point of time seems far easier than the journey was when we started out. You know, I have the greatest of... I'm greatly honored to be sitting beside John and to consider Hans a friend, and to be sitting with Stefan over here. It's a great honor. But 40 years back, when we spoke about the relationship between lifestyle and disease, and the probability that lifestyle could, if it causes disease, it can reverse disease, or at any rate, improve lifestyle can prevent disease. When we spoke about this with our medical colleagues, and I've had the absolute misfortune of only working in hospitals. So when we spoke to our medical colleagues about this, we were the lowest rung of the ladder. And everything that we said was rejected. And therefore, I am so grateful to these outstanding leaders in the field of lifestyle medicine who has made life so much easier for our young graduates. Whatever you need to prove in lifestyle medicine has been proved by hundreds of accepted researchers around the world. It has already been proved. So you no more need to establish the need for lifestyle medicine. The other great benefit that I see is 40 years back, or 37 odd years back, when I was designated as a corporate wellness manager, it was an organization that, it was a designation that most of my other management friends laughed at. They thought I was doing badly in my career to get such a designation. And today it gives me so much joy to see our corporate health professionals, to see our health professionals in almost every organization that I go to. Almost every organization that I go to, I see professionals who are certified in lifestyle medicine. Now, here, of course, is where sometimes the child becomes a parent to the parent. Now, even while I may have, or we may have in the Apollo Hospitals group, which is, we tied up with Harvard and did this 20, 30 years back, we created an academic program. But then, you know, the child becomes the father, and therefore I'm talking to Stephen over here. So we will get back to centralize all these credentials into a single global accreditation, which I think is a fabulous idea. So to cut a long story short, friends, I believe that the time has come, and the time is now, for our children who are graduating in lifestyle medicine to reap the benefits of the work that we have done, which will benefit society tremendously. Thank you.
thank you. And now the floor is open for questions from the audience. Thomas?
Thank you. Can I start? Okay. You do not hesitate to ask any questions, okay? This is the part where we should do that. Dr. John, can I ask you a very practical question what you were doing in UPA, Druskininke? Can you just briefly describe what were the main steps to achieve these remarkable numbers with these 10 patients in UPA? Thank you.
Sure, and thank you for the question. Of course, we love to talk about what we did. But the answer is so simple that, just like my colleague said, as a physician and as my colleagues who are physicians, we often feel like we ought to be doing something more. Shouldn't we be doing something? I mean, all we're doing is having breakfast with these people and going on a walk with them and talking to them, you know, and having chats with them. Surely we are, you know, I'm a doctor, I need to be doing something. So what we did, to be very practical, is we fed them a therapeutic diet based on evidence that shows that a largely whole food plant-based diet changes the gene switches in a favorable way that reduces insulin resistance, improves blood circulation, fights cholesterol levels, and so on. And it is an evidence-driven diet. It's a diet very similar to one I happen to eat myself, but that's because I like to do what's healthy myself. So we fed them a therapeutic diet. We had meals three times a day. I did tell them that if they wanted maximum therapeutic effect, they should only eat twice a day. But few of them went for the high dose. I have a little humor. Hopefully, don't be afraid to laugh at anything I say. I'm always making jokes. But anyway, for example, the first 3 days, we use what we call a jump start. It comes from terminology from the CHIP program. But basically, during the first 3 days, we told the kitchen, add no salt, add no sugar, add no oils, make this very bland food with lots of plant foods and plenty of raw things, salads and fruits. And the idea is it accelerates the cleansing process as our taste buds change and we start having bowel movements. You should have one bowel movement for each meal. That's not a bad gauge, okay? And I have patients all the time that they don't have a bowel movement, but every second day or maybe every third day. And so this is not good. Those things should get out of the body, not be in there all the time. Anyway, so we offered them a smoothie, a green smoothie in the evening for the supper meal, and for the first 3 days. And then after that, I allowed the kitchen, Brenda Davis, if she was here, she's my colleague in charge of the therapeutic diet. And we allowed the kitchen to use then some more, some salt and, you know, some of these other things. And the food, of course, was a little richer. It wasn't rich. It was a little richer. But what happened was, after 3 days of eating a very simple plant-based diet, taste buds changed, and they thought we had started pouring all the sugar and salt, and they thought it was wonderful. And we didn't really put much in there. But I've learned from experience. Let me just say this. I'm sorry, but I am a teacher, so I can't avoid doing a little teaching. If you try to reduce the amount of salt and sugar from day one and tell them, you know, and yet you're going to make it. In other words, it's better to do a 3 day cleanse and then put back some of the salt than to try to keep taking it out all the time, because the people then spend a whole week thinking, this is miserable, it's even more miserable than it was before. But if you start off very plain and then put it back in, then they have a very different reaction. Oh, this is not so bad after all. And there's a psychology to it. But anyway, I didn't figure that out. I just happened to read a lot, and that's what the research shows, and then I've tried it. The other thing we did is that we did exercise. We had, there's good science that shows that we should move after eating. Ideally, after every meal, we should be move for 30 minutes would be good. So we had a walk after after lunch. We did not move after every meal. We were busy because the last element I'm going to mention, and maybe very important, was education. We had many skeptics. To be very honest with you, I won't name any names, but there was a couple of people who, when they found out what was going to actually happen, they were ready to leave. Oh, I did not sign up for that. I did not know that's what we were going to do. And fortunately, I don't speak Lithuanian, so I did not know that for a couple of days. That's a joke too, but nonetheless, it's true. And if I would have known it, I would have ignored it. Because what we did, though, is we had their blood test, and then we started this, and we said, well, there's lectures. So we had two lectures every day, two talks, two education, because that's the part that is so important. And as they started to learn the science, they said, well, okay, well, maybe there's something to this, right? That's like I said earlier. I convinced them that there's something to it. My wife convinces, and with Loretta and other help, they convince them that not only something to it, but you can do this and enjoy it.
Okay, Hans?
I wonder if you can augment this just a little bit, John. So you talked about the importance of providing intellectual understanding, helping people to understand why you were doing this, right? How about the idea of how to? Did you have someone like Loretta somehow actually tell us about that?
Yes, I did not elaborate on it, but yes, an important part of the education was a third class we had each day, most days, and that was a cooking class, and we called it a class with a lab, because a lot of people are familiar with that terminology, right? You have the lecture, and then you go and you actually do the hands-on. And so, and we also, after every meal, Brenda Davis, who's an expert dietitian and published nutritionist, she would get up and talk about each element of the meal. Okay, we had this, and she would tell them about the characteristics of that particular bean or that particular food, and why we chose to serve it the way we did, and what the effects were on the health, and so on. So they were, and she's fascinating. I mean, I love listening to her talk about those things, and. The other thing I did not know when I got there, but I found out, was we had actually three physicians out of the 10 people, and you know, with all due respect, I think every human being deserves respect and good education. But when you're working with physicians, you better provide the evidence, and the science needs to be clear. And so we did that, and they were skeptical. Some of those physicians, matter of fact, maybe some of the most skeptical. But anyway. So yes, we had a cooking class and a practical aspect. We had tasting. These ladies would make the food first they actually served it, and then they would make a sample and so forth. So it was, that's very, very important, that practical part.
Okay, and we still have room for one question. Two questions.
Maybe for three questions.
Two, okay.
Okay, I hope it's... Okay, so I hope it's not a stupid question, but my curiosity... in my country, one of the biggest problems with patients with prescription is that they don't follow them to the full extent, or simply they misunderstand. So we talked about protected environment, because it was like research programs or something. So is the approach that you use for lifestyle medicine to a general practitioner? I mean, did you have any problems with the patient?
I work with a primary care practitioner in Southern California, so we got three clinics. We do just family medicine. We do shared medical appointments. We talk to people in groups. One of the key things of Hans's, of the CHIP program, is too that you do it together. Because togetherness, you know, from AA, Alcoholics Anonymous, or any other programs, we learn from the guru, we apply with each other. And so adherence and to reduce recidivism in people not doing anymore is when you connect them with each other. And so that walk after lunch, they don't do with the physician, they do with each other, right? The eating the food, you know, the sharing of the restaurants, the sharing of the recipes happens amongst the group. And as a medical practice, all we do is connect people. So we run SSM shared medical appointments. We do the CHIP programs as a group. So the physician isn't there because the physician's time is much too valuable to go and explain to every diabetic, every cardiovascular patient the same thing over and over. So you put them together in groups and they learn together, and that's how they stay adherent to the program, because it's no longer me that watches them, they watch out for each other. Does that make sense?
Yes, and let me just augment that by pointing out, what we did at UPA was it's not designed for a general practitioner, it would be for a specialist. The general practitioner would do what Stefan said, and it might work, let's say, for two-thirds of the people, but some of them, it just wouldn't take. So you send them to a residential center, and we up the dosage.
Yep.
Okay, one more question.
Yep.
Here.
Yes, questions. So I have two questions. I'm mom of two identical twins, girls. And first question is, they are identical, meaning the same DNA, but they are totally different physically. I'm not talking psychologically or mentally, but physically they are different. Why?
Well, that's a wonderful question. And it's not related to that, as far as I know, to lifestyle medicine. But nonetheless, let me tell you something I believe is the answer. Many of us do not realize that we are mosaics. If you really study genetics a little more closely, you'll find that many embryos and many humans, we actually came from two different eggs, and they merge early enough in embryonic development. And the way this is so obvious is they've had cases. There was a lady in California who was a single mother, and she applied for help from the government for her children. And when they did the blood test, they always checked to see that the DNA test to be sure this is really her children, and they arrested her because those children were not her children, and she had somehow stolen them. And she knew she had them in the she had them in the hospital. She knew this is my child. And what it turned out was she was a mosaic, and they took another sample of her tissue from a different location on her body, and sure enough, she was the mother. But the swab in her mouth did not match the DNA of the baby. So you may not only have identical twins, but they may be mosaics and not exactly identical. Check into that. You'll find it very interesting.
Thank you.
If I may just add to what John said, you're talking about having twins, but they are not identical.
They are identical.
But they are physically different.
Yes.
Okay.
I believe you.
I'm mom, so it's easier to believe me than the father. And the second question is a bit delicate, especially in the audience of medicine. So it's vaccines. As you know, our children receive a lot of vaccines, especially in USA. I'm not talking what they do there. They are killing children. But let's say now vaccines, some of them are genes engineering. How it affects our babies? Because my girls, they received a hepatitis B genes engineering vaccine. Thank you.
Well, I would love to answer that question with more time than I'm going to take. I'm just going to give a very short. But here's what I would say, and I'm not a I mean, I am a preventive medicine doctor, but I'm not an immunologist. I'm not a vaccine expert. I am a parent, and I'm cautious about genetic modification because I'm a biochemist and a molecular biologist. So I know enough. I did genetic engineering in my undergraduate. I've done it. I know how to do it. I know what it involves, and I'm not completely sure that we know how to do it safely. But that's beside the point. Your question, I think, was so here's what I want to say. I do believe, without a doubt, that there are vaccines that I am very glad were developed and deployed, like smallpox. I have no desire to go back to having smallpox. And I don't think that the harm that was done, and I do know there were some children who suffered from the smallpox. There's no doubt that happened. But I think as a society, it was the right thing to do. But I believe that what's happened is the technology of vaccination as an attempt to eliminate disease is getting to the edge of where the benefit-risk ratio is not the same as it was with smallpox. I am not sure that it's right to expose my daughter to Gardasil as a vaccination against cervical cancer when I'm going to teach her to save herself for marriage. She's not going to have every guy in town exposing her to various kinds of viruses. So I'm not in favor of forcing questionable vaccines on the public, but I am certainly not against vaccines.
Okay, thank you. And I look at my watch and I see that everyone deserved 1 hour break. Thank you, panelists, and I welcome all of you back after the break.